Sorry for that slight technical delay there. Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. Our first item of business is an evidence session with college principals and deputy principals for our college regionalisation inquiry. Our first panel are representatives from colleges in multi-college regions, so I would like to welcome Anne Baxter, Deputy Principal for Students and Curriculum at New College Lanarkshire, Sue McFarlane, Interim Principal and Chief Executive Officer of UHI Outer Hebrides College, and Derek Smeal, Principal and Chief Executive of Glasgow Kelvin College. And thank you all for your time this morning. And our session is hybrid today, and on this panel, Sue McFarlane is participating virtually. Sue, as you won't be able to, well, you might be able to catch my eye as I'm looking directly at you, but it might be best if you can put an R in the chat box and when you wish to speak, and the clerks will be monitoring that and we'll bring you in when we can. The committee has a lot of questions this morning, so let's get started. And I think first instance, if we go to opening questions from my colleague Graham Day, please.
Thank you, Kavira, and good morning to the panel. We want to start by just getting a feel from yourselves of your views on the extent to which regionalisation has achieved its aims, what positives have come out of it, and I guess any negatives that have come out of it. Who wants to start? Derek?
Yep, desperate. No, don't need to press any buttons. Yes, it's interesting. Coming from a multi-college region, perhaps would start with perhaps trying to avoid the conflation between merger and regionalisation. Now, they were absolutely inextricably linked. There's no doubt about that whatsoever. However, in this particular instance, from my perspective, there were two parallel actions. So, for example, I can say quite clearly, representing my other fellow principals within the Glasgow region, that the concept of merger, we went from 9 colleges down to 3, was a positive process. It was a challenging process, there's no doubt about that, but there were many benefits came out of that. If we separate then the construct of the regionalisation, that is a slightly different perspective we need to take. My position on that, or our view, and my view in particular within that, it was perhaps a missed opportunity, and that's something I could perhaps expand on in a minute or two. For example, the positives as far as merger is concerned, we certainly established institutions of size, of volume, of influence. There's no doubt that it resulted in improved working with our universities, both locally and nationally, and in some cases internationally. It certainly got us at the table in many aspects. We had the ability to get, over a period of years, I might add, some efficiencies of scale. However, as we've gone through the years, due to not a static, but a moving landscape, it's very difficult to discern and identify that. But I am clear that over the period of time, over the past number of years, had we not merged, we would not be in the position we were at the moment. However, I'll perhaps touch on the future moving forward in that as well. From a regionalisation perspective, what I mean from a missed opportunity, most regionals, or if not all, regions were established on the boundaries of local authorities, for example. And I think it has been said by some of the participants previously to the committee about the fact that that might not have been appropriate in all cases. When we have single college entities within a region, it may make sense. But for example, within Glasgow, I think there's been a missed opportunity for regionalisation, because I think regionalisation should be more than the local authority boundaries. I think we're wider than that. For example, my colleagues to my left in North Lanarkshire, we know there is a pattern of travel to work, of travel to study, that goes much, much wider than the local authority, for example. We also know there's cultural links within there, but probably more important is the economic movement movement back and forward between North Lanarkshire, South Lanarkshire, Renfrewshire and East Dumbartonshire, for example. So I do think the concentration and the focus there, there's been a bit of a missed opportunity that we're not focusing that economic, social entity there. But I do think there's still opportunities for the future. So there are a number of areas where I think we've got things right. I think there's been a little bit of a missed opportunity where the focus has been purely on the construct of governance, for example, moving forward. I think there's been a bit of an opportunity that's been missed there. The difficulties and challenges of moving forward, I must say, is, and there's one thing I would like to get the opportunity to speak in more depth about, is what I would describe as the chronic underfunding of colleges, and particularly when we're looking at the projection over the next 5 years. Also, as far as the governance of the region and the focus on the governance level, I would like to move to a much more focused approach as far as the economy, communities, and getting the benefit of scale of that economic region as opposed to the boundary of local government.
Other colleagues, no doubt, will cover the funding issues. Anybody else want to contribute on this topic?
Well, I would actually like to say that I think regionalisation has brought many opportunities for us. I think we're able to work collaboratively with our local authority, the NHS, and with the other college in the region. I think it's difficult just to say, you know, what the impacts have been of regionalisation, because there were many things that happened at the same time, such as, you know, the change of the profile of the students, which was part of the policy changes, you know, other reforms such as the implementation of the student association. At the point of merger stroke regionalisation, one of the legacy colleges did not have a student association in Lanarkshire, and I think that was a disadvantage, and I really welcome the role of our student association in the college life and the input they make to the board.
Okay, thank you.
Sue, online.
Thank you. I just want to say that I wasn't in the college sector when regionalisation took place, so I came into it following this. But I do have a view on how it impacted on the UHI, having worked in the UHI pre-regionalisation. I think it's brought many benefits. UHI is in a slightly different place because of its tertiary nature, but I have seen an impact in terms of the coherence for its FE provision across the regional region. I think what regionalisation brought in terms of the FE provision around UHI is a much more coherent approach to how the colleges within the UHI work together, more collegiate, more collaborative, planning FE on a regional basis whilst retaining a focus on local. So I think there were opportunities that we were able to benefit from, able to plan for economic benefit across the region as the multi-colleges. My colleague mentioned student association, a much more joined up, consistent approach to student support using Highlands and Islands Student Association. So a number of things that we benefited from. But I think, as my colleague also, there were problems in terms of alignment of with local authorities, and the region doesn't particularly, it's not cohesive in terms of where colleges are aligned at local level and with sub-regions, if you like. I'd like to pick up on the financial problems and other matters later on as well. So I just want to make the point that UHI is slightly different, but still had some benefit from regionalisation. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. That's helpful. Mr. Day, you have some further questions.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Derek Smith, you talked there about the greater influence that merged colleges have had. Can I explore briefly, has there come parity of esteem with universities? Are you treated, is it a partnership of equals? Have you found that sort of aspect has improved?
That has certainly improved, but I do think there's still a journey as far as that's concerned. If I could give an example for Glasgow Kelvin College, if you would have asked me this question, you know, maybe 15 years ago, about a relationship with the universities in Lowe. One example is with Glasgow University, where we have a direct progression of 1 year at the college, for example, and you get advanced standing at Glasgow University in either engineering or science. I would have said that that would have been almost impossible. It wouldn't have been in my mind at that point. But so there's an example of that credibility, getting to the table, having that influence and working alongside. Obviously, Scottish Government policy has a lot to do with that as well, so there's no doubt in that example. Anne has mentioned, for example, in North Lanarkshire, and certainly within the Glasgow region, working with the NHS and NHS education, etc., that has brought a more coherent grouping of colleges. What I might add is something we forget within the Glasgow region, which is quite unique, is we have two quite large community-based colleges and a city centre college that serve slightly different purposes and slightly different strategies, but in the right place at the right time. However, by volume, it is just short of 25% of all college education in the whole of Scotland. But you would expect that because of the size of the conurbation. So there's no doubt that collectively, as the three colleges, we also work very, very closely. And I think this is an important point. The Glasgow Colleges Group of the three colleges are led by the three principals, and a lot of the practical, operational and indeed strategic advantages that we've gained over the years have come not just collectively of the merged colleges. I mentioned we came from nine down to three, but also the three colleges working together collegiately.
So one last question, if I may, Kavira. And in your view and the views of anyone else on the panel, has merger and regionalisation led to the reduction in duplication of courses, so that the offering is more tailored, perhaps? And in the context of the relationship with employers, particularly SMEs, is the college offering now better tailored to their needs than it was previously?
I believe that the general answer to that is yes. Certainly within, again, talking about the Glasgow region, we do have a curriculum plan for the whole of Glasgow that is dealt with. The individual colleges at that level work on a week-by-week, month-by-month basis, so there's definitely reduction in duplication. But I would hasten to add unnecessary duplication, because certain duplication is necessary, and particularly when you're delivering at the heart of communities. And as we said, Glasgow is an enormous conurbation with very different areas and communities within that. So it's very important for me to say the reduction in unnecessary and inappropriate duplication. But what it has also done is provided very clear pathways for students from the lowest levels at entry right the way through to perhaps then progressing on to university. Just to pick up and to finally mention, for example, SMEs, for example. SMEs are obviously, it's very difficult to get by definition, a defined voice from SMEs, but of course we work very closely with FSB, as many of the regions and colleges do. An example of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which only recently last year was then adapted to allow access from small to medium-sized enterprises, that was extremely successful from the point of view of Glasgow Kelvin, and in fact to the point that we were actually oversubscribed from SMEs as opposed to levy paying companies. So I believe, working in conjunction with the other two large colleges, I think we provided a very rapid service there, and I hope that would continue. So again, yes, I think the answer is there to support SMEs.
Thank you, Kavira.
Thank you. I want to follow up on some of the SME questions there, but I just want to check. Sue, are you wanting to come in on anything? No, you're okay. That's great. So we heard specifically from yourself, Derek, about the SMEs and how you do some engagement, but I'm interested, given that the very diverse nature of our economy, is what the other colleges are doing in terms of engagement with SMEs, because in rural specific areas there will be more small businesses rather than the large businesses. So I'm interested to understand what you're doing to seek to respond to your local skills needs specifically in your areas as well. And in terms of those micro-credentials we've been hearing about from businesses, what your activities you're actually carrying out in your colleges as well. So perhaps can I take that question first to you, Anne? Thank you.
Well, I'd like to share something with you in relationship to that and also linking to the university. At New College Lanarkshire, we've been supporting businesses and innovation as part of our partnership model, as part of our Smart Hub Lanarkshire. And that's a partnership with our local authority, North Lanarkshire Council, the University of Strathclyde and ourselves. And it's a home for robotics and automation training. And it's a place for SMEs to come in, to explore, to test, to undertake, you know, discussions with staff, where they meet and learn and support from one another. And they have live demonstration of cobots, or the small robots. And from April to June this year, we had nearly 400 different people come in to undertake part of this training. So that's one of the approaches that we take. And if you, as part of Colleges Scotland event taking place in the Parliament on the 5th of October, we will have that available for people to see. In addition, we have monthly meetings where we invite small businesses in to discuss their needs, plans for the future.
Thank you. Thank you, Anne. Sue, would you like to come in, please? Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah. Higher and further education level. So we, for example, at the college, we have an innovation hub where small and medium enterprises, in fact, any employees are able to come and test out different processes they wish to put in place, test out prototyping. It's an area where we encourage startup companies to come along and access expertise of staff and equipment. We're working with our local hospitality SMEs, which is so important in the Outer Hebrides, and adapting our provision for shoulder month training, working with them in terms of tailored courses and using things like the Flexible Workforce Development Fund to support our small businesses. We work across the university partnership around knowledge exchange, research and knowledge exchange, use of innovation vouchers to make sure that we're supporting the our businesses through our research activity and passing on our knowledge to help improve their business practices. So a range of things that we're doing with partners in collaboration, but also at local level for our local businesses.
Thank you. Just want to check, Bob, do you have anything? Did you want to come in?
No, I can pick mine up later.
Okay.
You're fine. You're
okay. No, that's great. Thank you for that. I think if Stephanie Callaghan, can we move to questions from yourself now, please?
Yeah, certainly. Apologies, convener.
That's okay.
Lost my page. So I just had a couple of questions around student experiences. What progress has been made since college regionalisation with that? How has it improved it and what have the challenges been? And first to Anne, thanks.
To Anne first, oh, okay.
Okay, well, thank you. As I mentioned, prior to regionalisation, one of our legacy colleges did not have a student association, and as I said, it's really important that the voice and the needs of students are known by the senior leadership team and the board. So that has now been addressed, partly by funding that was initially established to take it forward. I think the college life for students has improved. We have a team now of learning engagement officers that try to ensure that we have a varied programme that will keep students engaged. So they've done things like gamification, where they support the learning process, organise activities, they organise freshers. So I think overall student experience has improved since regionalisation.
And can I just ask you, as a wee kind of follow-up to that, around the challenges of it as well? There, we certainly heard in previous evidence that, you know, independence can be an issue. That some students felt that, yes, they were right at the centre of things and their voices were being heard, but others felt quite the opposite of that, really, that they couldn't actually, you know, see the things that they wanted to see and put forward their views.
I suspect that might have been a part of time. I certainly know that during the COVID experience for students, where there has been less contact with others, where there's been less input on campus, many students and staff found that quite a challenging experience. I would hope that as we begin to restore back to where we were, that things will improve. I admit there may be challenges, but it's something that we have to be alert to. And certainly our student association are very able at making us known where things aren't as good as they could be.
Thank you. Wondering if anyone else wants to contribute there?
Derek, and then Sue. Okay.
Yes, thank you. It's very interesting. And again, I would reflect everything that Anne said over the period of time. There has been recognition, which is very important for the Students' Association. They have been brought front and centre in the formal structures, but probably what I would want to mention is about the informal structures and the huge amount of work that I know colleagues are doing throughout the colleges in Scotland. So we do have direct representation, for example, in the boards of management by the Students' Association president at both college and regional level, and they're very proactive in that. But one of the key elements of that is building confidence in individuals, because the amount of information and the technicalities can be absolutely overwhelming to anyone within that position. So we do also go out a way to have infrastructures within the colleges to support the individuals. And although they are employees of the college, they are as independent as they possibly can be. But to be clear, the Student Association, our purpose is to ensure that they have that level of independence. The other thing that I might want to emphasise is that there's a lot of effort put into the informal. For example, I'll give you an example of my own college. I meet with the student presidents personally, chairing an informal meeting once every 2 weeks. And it also involves the union colleagues locally and staff and some key managers. And again, it's an opportunity to really to build confidence and take ownership of decisions that are actually made. And we do actually make quite influential decisions, and there's the opportunity to influence directly the principal, but they also can influence in the more formal structures of the boards of management or whatever. So different colleges do it in slightly different ways, but I think it's very important to recognise there's a significant effort to support the individuals in informal means to build their confidence so that they can then challenge and put forward their position and support the learners. But there's probably a whole range of examples that could be given of how we encourage that engagement and build that confidence.
Thank you, Derek. Can we go over to Sue now online? Thanks.
Thank you. Really, I've only got a couple of things to add to what Anne and Derek have said. But I think what regionalisation's brought in terms of the student experience is a regional students association which ensures that there's consistency of approach across the different colleges. We've worked with our colleagues in the students association to make sure that we have now a consistent set of student front-facing policies, for example, that we share across all the colleges, so that we've got consistency of approach. We've got a regional students association which has a model that has paid officers as well as elected representatives all sitting on our boards. But that has to be underpinned by the quality of how we support that at local level as well. And I think what we have from a regional point of view is ensuring that that local consistency is there, and that's really important. So really that's all I've got to add to what colleagues have said. I think that there's work still to be done, and I think that there's the funding issue around how we support our students' associations. That's getting tighter and tighter. And so I think that's actually being impacted at the moment in terms of what the student association can do. And that puts pressure on the partnership between the colleges and the student association around ensuring that not only the informal support, but more formal support and activity that really students need, especially as we've come out of COVID and they're wanting to up the experience of an in-person student experience on campus, not just with their learning, but around their learning as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. I suppose on that, you know, we've heard some evidence in the, from the SQA that there's a reduction in the assessment contents. This is a bit more about formal learning during their last two exam years at school. So there has been a fear that result the pupils are not as prepared when they come to further education. Is that something that you've seen or have experience of in your colleges? And Sue's nodding fervently, so we'll go to Sue first, if you don't mind. Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the funding has ceased in terms of dealing with COVID, but we're still dealing with the legacy of COVID, with young people leaving school. We're having to catch them up in terms of their learning and the skill set. So we're putting in additional support around their learning. But also there's the little bit around the legacy on the social side of things. And so we're working hard with our student association colleagues to look at how we improve the student experience and build that confidence that Derek spoke of, the social side of their learning. So there are extra things that we're having to do to support in all ways, and yet the funding has disappeared, and I think there's not been enough attention paid to that aspect of things. Thanks.
Thank you, Sue. Does anyone else want to contribute? Ask Derek.
Just reflecting on Sue's words there, absolutely. One of the things that colleges, I think, do extremely well, but it has been extremely challenging, and this will probably go on for another 2-3 years. Students have been affected, or pupils coming from college in the transition. There is about building confidence, but it's also about the mental health, which is something we obviously need to pay attention to. And again, that is under stress at the moment. But again, the big message that we're trying to get across is we've had this great opportunity now. It's almost like we're coming out of a slumber. The students are feeling that. There's a positive vibe in the campuses that I haven't seen. That noise and that background hasn't been there for almost 3 years, and many colleagues comment on it, and anybody that enters the college. But it's about putting the fun back. I know it's a little bit of a catch, but putting the fun back in that learning and getting young people to enjoy their lives again. And I think the social aspect, the community aspect of it is critically important. And I do think it's a massive contribution to the improvement of young people's mental health as well. And to the communities that they live within as well.
Lots of nodding there. That's really great to hear. Thank you so much. I know, Bob, I don't know if you want to say anything further, Anne.
Just to say very briefly that the comments that are made are very reflective, but we felt it was important to have lots of fun at the start of term. So we actually had an extended freshers. So
freshers fortnight.
Well, not quite a fortnight, but much longer than we would normally have. So okay. It was very successful.
That's great. I know Bob Dorris has got a question on this as well. Thanks.
It's because Mr. Smeal mentioned community involvement, I thought was appropriate.
Yes.
That was one of the key aspects of regionalisation was, I feel like, not to throw the baby out with the bathwater, to make sure that colleges remain anchored in their communities despite that economies of scale and greater pool and reach that regionalisation can bring. Those least likely to apply to college are most likely to get involved in some localised community activity around the very localised offers of colleges. That clearly had shut down completely during COVID. Can I ask how that's going just now? And maybe say a little bit more about the importance of the work in communities, getting those least likely to apply to college in the first place, that pre-employability, that pre-training work that I think colleges do so well. How is that faring now, and what are the challenges? Maybe Mr. Smeal.
Yes, thanks. It's a very pertinent and very important question for ourselves at Glasgow Kelvin College. Historically, we serve primarily the northeast, north and east of Glasgow, very high levels of deprivation. If we look statistically at Glasgow Kelvin College, by far our proportion of learners are from SIMD 20 and SIMD 10, for example. But getting back to the point, yes, we have some large campuses that are also right in the heart of the communities, but we had in excess of 40 learning centres where opportunities were given. They were completely shut down over COVID. What the answer to is, it's not recovering, coming back to the way it was. We're having to reinvent the situation. We look on it as an opportunity, However, it's extremely challenging, especially in the current fiscal situation. The work that we do in the outreach, we take education to the communities to then, and it is about, but I use the term over and over again about building confidence. It's to then give them, build enough confidence to allow them to enter the doors of our larger establishments and given that those learning pathways and going on. We've been very successful over the years. However, that work I would describe as high cost, but very, very high impact. Mm-hmm. And it suffers at any point when we have contraction of funding or increasing in cost, etc. It's very vulnerable to that. However, to be clear, certainly from my own college, it is an absolute strategic priority for ourselves. So we have had some success, and what we've actually done is expanded within some of our larger companies, for example, in Easterhouse, to give more opportunities directly. So we're taking certain education, for example, technology and engineering and social care and so on and so forth, and health into those communities. But as a major challenge, we're having to use digital resources mm-hmm. much more effectively to maintain our net capture and availability to our students. And again, financially, that is a considerable strain. So I would say in answer, there's a considerable way to go to re-establish that contact with the community, and it's very, very challenging, but we're making headway.
I think that's very helpful, the kind of high cost but high reward. It's important to put that on the record in the funding climate.
I think Sue was looking to come into your
I'd
first
love
point
to hear
as well.
From Sue, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
Sue, over to you.
Lovely, thank you very much. Obviously, you can imagine we operate in a very rural environment, and operating in the community is absolutely vital for us. We have a distributed model with a number of smaller learning centres, which Derek's alluded to. Financially, it's an expensive model, but in terms of reaching to our communities, into the fragile areas of where we serve, it's absolutely imperative. So we operate on a basis of we are the college and university in the community. And so it's not just about ensuring that there's online provision down there, but that is one way. You know, we've extended our digital provision, but we have to have staff on the ground who have that connection with our local communities, our local employers, and the fragile learners who want to access learning and training, but in their local area. And I think it's really important that that is not lost through the big economies of scale, especially in the more fragile communities. So we run a series of employability programs. We do have in all our centres activity that just get people into the centre to get some confidence about being there and interacting with small groups of learners and small groups of staff, even pre-formal learning. There's informal learning going on, community activity. That is just about having our presence and building confidence in using the college down there. So this is the issue that we have to make sure that we're still cognizant of. Is regionalisation has brought lots of opportunity around economies of scale, around breaking down duplication, but we have to make sure that that isn't lost in terms of the balance that we have in local presence. We're there for the communities, and I think that's the wider role of colleges. It's not just about the learning, but it's about inputting into the fragility of some of our communities and making sure that we're providing different services that are linked to learning, but not solely about learning. And I think that's the thing that we have to make sure that we protect, but that is costly. Talking about the digital side of things, I think that absolutely widens access, but it only goes so far. However, during COVID, what we found is we were still able to engage with lots of communities through online events. You know, we did Kayleys, we did community quizzes, that kind of thing. So the colleges still have a real role to play in the social aspect of our communities, especially where the fragile learners are and where fragile communities are. Sorry, I'm starting to witter. That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I could come back and just...
You've got one final question, is that correct, Bob?
Yes. Yep. Okay. And it's to Mr. Spiel, I was going to explore duplication, but Mr. Day's done that amply, I think. But you had said within your answer to Mr. Day, I think you talked about Glasgow Colleges Group. Is there a distinction between the Glasgow Colleges Group and the Glasgow Colleges Regional Board? Because obviously I was looking through Jane McCusker's submission on behalf of all of the Glasgow Colleges earlier in this inquiry, and there was mixed views on whether that was an additional required layer or whether that was duplication. So is there a difference between the Glasgow Colleges Group and the Regional Board? And what's your thoughts on the mixed views of the Regional Board itself?
Yeah, I think it's no secret that there are mixed views within the region. What I can say is the views of all three colleges are absolutely in line. They don't always agree with the GCRB perspective. Glasgow Colleges Group are solely run by the Glasgow Colleges, so they're led by the three Glasgow principals, and we have a structure that is high-level operational, but also strategic in delivering policy, delivering the strategy within the region. The GCRB is very much a governing body, quite clearly have very specific responsibilities. However, one of the issues is it's highly transactional. It's transactional governance, and again, the opinion of the three principals is it's massively duplicating the strategic operations of the college. One example, we have three principals who are also the principals and chief executives of the three individual colleges, but we work very collegiately as part of the Glasgow Colleges Group. However, none of us are actually members of the GCRB board, which I must say, as a model, I find very strange, and it makes that connection between the GCRB board and directing the movement of the colleges within the region very challenging, and hence my reference to it's very transactional and has a lot of duplication within there. However, the actual progress that's delivered, or the, shall I say, the powerhouse, the driving force behind that, again, in the opinion of the principals, is the Glasgow Colleges Group. So it's very distinctly different. Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Mr. Willie Rennie has a supplementary on this, and then we'll move into...
I'm just puzzled by what you've just said. I mean, what's the logic for you not being on the board? What's the explanation?
If I could say... I have, perhaps I'll take a step back. I've been in position for 3 years now. I was appointed as the principal of Glasgow Kelvin College, and to this day I'm still astonished. I don't understand it. I can't answer that, I'm afraid.
And what do ministers tell you?
My understanding is there was obviously a Glasgow order, there was a Lanarkshire order that defined the specific details and breakdown of the constitution of the board at the time. I wasn't there at that time. However, I believe it was discussed at the time, and the decision of the board was that the chairs would not be members. And I understand historically it was within the gift of the decisions at that time.
Do you attend meetings?
I attend. Yeah, absolutely. To be clear, we attend meetings. We have good working relationships with the executive team of GCRB. So there are a number of executive employees as the GCRB support the board. However, for example, the executive director, who is the executive member of staff who supports the chair and the work of the board, is not employed by the colleges and is not directly involved in the work of the colleges.
So do you attend the board meetings?
I attend the board meetings
every time.
The same way as, for example, at my college, I am a member of the board and I'm a voting member of the board because of my position. However, obviously, the executive senior team attend the boards. And they're there basically to answer questions, reflect and give any advice when called upon. My position as a principal at GCRB is to give information, evidence when called upon. I am not a voting member.
And do you think mistakes are made as a result?
That is possible. I don't think it is an appropriate model from my own position. And as
does,
I say,
does it make any real difference, though?
Okay, thank you. Now, can we move on to questions from the Vice Convener, Cogab Stewart, please?
Thank you, convener. I just wanted to have a touch on finances. So I'm just going to ask, to what extent have colleges the longer-term financial planning? Has that improved in recent years? What's the impact of that been? Derek, would you like to kick off? And
yeah, thank you. Looking back retrospectively, especially over COVID, for example, I think colleges in general, our ability to forward plan, to analyse, to work very closely with the Scottish Funding Council, and most recently the government officers as well during the COVID period. I do think I'm using a Scottish Funding Council term when I talk about the emergency years. It was a term that was used. Now, that is not to suggest it was chaos, quite the opposite. I welcomed the openness of the Scottish Funding Council, how they worked with colleges, and long may that continue. So from a positive point of view, I would say particularly over the past 3 years, the openness of the Scottish Funding Council. My connection with the Funding Council and finance goes back quite a bit when I was a vice principal as well, but over the past 3 years, as I've been a principal, I've seen that improve significantly from transaction level to the highest level of the Funding Council. That said, the restrictions in the fiscal environment are absolutely enormous. I made the statement there about chronic underfunding. Now, historically, over a period of time, yes, funding has moved, but our cost base has expanded way beyond the funding base over a period of time, for example. And that has generally, over the last few years, resulted in redundancies through voluntary severance to get efficiencies and to deliver as best we can. That has been extremely challenging. To move on to the future now, so yes, we have become more sophisticated and more collaborative in amongst colleges, at Colleges Scotland, and with our colleges at the Scottish Funding Council. We have asked over a period of time for longer projected guidance from the Scottish Government, which they have recently provided. Obviously, we've got the three-year provisional allocation, but also we've had an extended projection of 5 years. However, that has been presented as flat cash, for want of a better word. Mm. Now, in reality, when we have now done our analysis, now I can only speak on behalf of my own colleague. We have gone through that analysis, and the reason I use the chronic underfunding and as we go forward, the impact of that, again, at this early stage, is likely to mean the reduction on my workforce by the end of year five, which is 2027, of 25%. Now, I'm sure everybody around the table could recognise if I reduce my workforce for 25%, my college will simply not be the same place that it is now. Don't get me wrong, I'm not suggesting that our productivity, our opportunities would shrink by the same proportion, because we will be driving for those efficiencies, but it would be seriously impacted. There will be lots of hard decisions being made. And to reassure members, we are not shying away from hard decisions. We just need to make sure that there's an understanding of what those decisions mean. And going back to the point we were talking about high impact and high cost, there needs to be judgment made going forward on that. What I ask is that we don't lose sight of that. We must understand if there's an inevitability to this, which we all accept that there must be. This is a worldwide situation, not just for Scotland, so we absolutely accept that. And when I use the term, we need to address the chronic underfunding, there are many ways you can address it. There's one way, obviously, the simple way to gain more funding, to look at how it's distributed, or the other way is to accept what the future looks like. In the future, at the moment, in my analysis, is the potential of loss of 25% of my workforce by the end of 2027. Mm. Now, will that happen? Will that manifest? At the moment, that is a projection and the advice that we are being given to analyse and project towards.
Mm. Do the other two witnesses want to add anything to that? I want to come back in, but I just want to give you an opportunity just now.
go to Anne first and then Sue.
I can't explain, you know, a lot about funding because it's not really, well, it's part of my remit, but I wouldn't be an expert in it. But colleges have to start to use funding more imaginatively. There was additional funding available for national qualifications and to maximise the benefit for our students. South Lanarkshire College and ourselves co-delivered stuff, extra revision sessions that students could share, drop in, share resources. So that was how we tried to maximise what I thought was quite limited funding for the benefit of our students.
Okay, good example.
Thank you.
Sue?
Yeah, I would repeat most of what Derek has said, but I think there are still opportunities for growth across the sector, and I think we have to do things a little bit differently. One of the reasons, for example, why UHI Outer Hebrides is involved in merger talks is an opportunity to achieve the opportunity, the economic opportunities that are available for the colleges in terms of got wind, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there's still opportunities to generate increased income, but the cost base has gone up so much that we're actually, all our efforts are dissipated on just keeping ourselves above water at the moment. And, you know, lack of investment to be able to make some of the changes that we require. We're running to keep up financially. As Derek said, we're predicting almost a 25% reduction in our workforce over the next 3 to 5 years. That will have an impact, especially on rural economies. And Anne talked about using income differently. I think those we're under pressure that, and we need to take account of the fact that colleges now. We've got competition through private training providers, local authorities. That's impacted on the college market. So we've got pressure on income sources in lots of different ways. We've got the inability to invest in doing things differently. So there are opportunities, but we are constrained in taking those opportunities.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I mean, sort of like, you know, Audit Scotland sort of did recognise that the pressures were sort of exacerbated by inflationary costs and rising costs and everything. So I'm glad to hear that, you know, that's been mentioned. So, I mean, I believe that it was sort of like many, many years ago, was it 2014, that the Office for National Statistics sort of announced that prior to regionalisation, of course, that colleges throughout the UK would be considered as public bodies. So that means that it's sort of like central government funding, but there is scope, because I was reading, to have sort of like arm's length organisations that can be set up in order for you to generate funding, because I'm aware that you can't build up reserves. I'd be interested to hear a little bit more about that, maybe even an example of where that has happened in order for colleges to generate funding. Derek?
If perhaps I could come back, again, talking in the context of the Glasgow College, well, specifically Glasgow Kelvin College. ONS classification meant that colleges cannot hold cash reserves. That's the first element, so you're quite right. There was an element that what we could do, if there was any surplus cash, it could be transferred into arm's length foundations. Within, however, they are independent. They have, as by definition, their arm's length, and they have very educational, pedagogic purposes. They can't just be used for example, plugging holes in business models, for example. However, what I would say is, I am not aware of any college having added to their arm's length foundation for many, many years, because the only way to add to it is to create a surplus, and I'm not aware of any college creating significant enough surpluses to do that. So it is not a function that's available to us. In my own colleges, yes, there is still some funding that's available. However, the projection that I mentioned to you earlier, over the 5 years, our ALF will be empty within the first 3 years. Immediately, we have to empty that ALF to sustain other core development and displace then our expenditure elsewhere. So that's one example. I can't speak on behalf of any other colleges, but I think many colleges are now in a position either they have no ALF, or you know there's virtually no money within the ALF, or their ALFs will be committed over the next 3 to 5 years and they will disappear. But you're absolutely correct, there is a mechanism. One of the difficulties within that, it is not an accessible business funding, for example, to go through normal initiatives. The other thing that we can't do is we can't borrow. There might be certain capital aspects of that. The one thing that's very difficult, we mentioned about innovation, and I think Anne was quite right, we need to think differently. And I want to be very positive in my response to you. Colleges are innovative. We will come back with new ideas. But one of the things that ONS does that restricts you is you cannot pre-seed any funding or development in advance of that. Because at the moment, we're on a sustainability budget. If I want to create a new product and perhaps seek alternative streams of funding, be that other public funding or commercial funding or privately funded, many colleges have no way of investing in that up front, and that's because they don't carry cash reserves to do it, or the restrictions on their ALF don't allow them to invest in those specific areas for commercial benefit, for example. It has to be for the benefit of the student. So there are, it's shrouded by a lot of constraints within there. One position I held a number of years ago was the chair of the audit committee of SAS, Student Awards Agency for Scotland, which is a government department. So I gained a lot of experience there as we're transitioning through to ONS. But my reflection was that we got all of the disadvantage of coming under the ONS system, but none of the advantage of it. And that would be my overarching conclusion there. So it is restrictive, and it does, I think, stifle the potential for innovation in colleges.
Sue, you want to come in now?
Yes, thank you. I would agree with Derek in that not many of us have surplus to invest in our Anslinger foundations. In fact, we're carrying a deficit this year, which we had planned, and we've got a clear financial recovery plan to get out of, but that's been hit by the flat cash funding, the cost of living crisis, etc., etc. So things are getting hard. One of the things that Derek said was we have all the disadvantages of ONS and none of the advantages. One of the things that we really need as a college sector is for some flexibility around that breaking even by end of year. Now, I previously worked at SQA where we were ONS, but there was some flexibility around the end of year position and carrying forward some the balance to the next year. The colleges need that flexibility, and without that, this is just going to keep going year on year. We're not going to get out of this crisis at all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Willie Rennie, you have a supplementary? Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I've remarked on this before. I'm just astonished that all of this is very managerial. I mean, the college sector has been cut for year on end. The college places have been reduced significantly for years. Yet the presentation you give this morning is very managerial and almost accepting of the position. I can't understand why you're not more angry. And secondly, what are you doing to persuade the government to change its mind on funding levels?
Derek first, then Sue, perhaps then Anne.
Certainly, I wouldn't use the word angry. Certainly frustrated, professionally frustrated. I'll perhaps go back to the point I was making about the 25%. This is the reality now of moving forward. In the past, we have been talking about mergers and regionalisation. Efficiencies have been accommodated over the years. It has reduced the workforce. It makes it more difficult to be innovative. It makes it more difficult to progress. I think there was mentioned before about micro-credentials, for example. That's a really, really important element. We are really struggling to be able to free up staff just monetarily. Yes, I'm speaking very functional terms there, but there is potential. Well, it's not potential. There are consequences to what we're actually talking about here. And the biggest picture I can paint is, in our minds, is our projections are saying 25% of the workforce will have gone. And again, without going into to the detail, that puts stress. The first areas that will come under stress and are courses that are not, in a business sense, in a model, efficient, regardless if they're effective or impactful. So I've got to balance up to what's socially impactful and what's affordable and so on. And I'm very, very, very concerned of being forced down a road that I need to make decisions that I do not agree with or I don't want to make professionally and have that impact. Absolutely, we are willing and we are able to work within these envelopes, but we must be clear on what the consequences of that are. And certain elements must be protected, the social elements, the community elements, going forward. But it is an incredibly difficult position. Now, I know technically a public body cannot become, my understanding, cannot become insolvent. However, colleges could be put in a position where they're driven towards that. And the only alternative is, to be clear, is the reduction in staff. If I go back, I think it's mentioned by the Auditor General about the proportion of staffing funding, which has increased year after year after year. And it's stated it's 70% of income, I think, on average. To clarify that, that's 70% of total income. However, for most colleges, I think I'm correct in saying for most colleges, certainly for my own college, it's actually 80% of what I would refer to as accessible income or revenue. Because not all that revenue that's quoted as 70% of is actually accessible. For example, some of the student support funding, some of the childcare, we're simply custodians of it. So in my college, it's in excess of 80% of my accessible revenue has to go on staffing. So by simple mathematics, if that funding is cut, there is absolutely no alternative that that can come. It's not efficiencies, to be quite honest with you. The word efficiency is a euphemism for the downsizing of the workforce. But again, to emphasise in a positive sense, we will drive for efficiencies. As Sue said, we will be working differently. As Anne says, we will be working differently. But it will still have a huge, enormous impact, which, as an educationalist professionally, I'm extremely concerned. And again, the social aspect of it. We talked earlier about bringing the fund back, mental health and our young people taking it forward. There is a potential of damage for that, because we simply won't be able to deliver the number of opportunities and the breadth of opportunities, but also in the breadth of locations and geography okay. In our communities.
Thank you, Derek. I know Sue McFarlane's keen to come in on this as well. If we can go to Sue. Thank you.
Thank you. Just directly, it sounds as though I'm not directly answering, but I am. There's always been an old adage that you go to the education sector and ask for something to be done, and you'll go to the school sector and they'll say, where are all the resources? You go to the university sector and they'll say, let me go away and think hard and long about that before getting back to you. You go to the college sector and say, when do you want it done by? So in some ways, Mr. Rennie, we are very angry, but we're victims of the fact that we just get on with it and we find solutions and we move forward. And I think that's what the college sector's been doing. We work in the constraints and we do the best that we can for our learners. But I think there is anger, I think there's frustration, but we're absolutely tired out as well, because this is year on year. We've come to a perfect storm in just now, but we've been dealing with underfunding and lack of parity of esteem for the sector for a long, long time. And that needs to change. But I think there's a tiredness around the sector. So we are trying to be strategic, but there is anger. We work through Scotland's colleges, etc. But this isn't new for us, and this is the problem. Regionalisation hasn't solved the problem around funding, but we're in a perfect storm now. So I think, please don't think we're not angry, because we are, but we keep getting on with it.
Thank you. Oh, thank you, Sue. Ms. Graham Day has a small supplementary on this one.
One of the luxuries MSPs have in this place is to be able to call for more funding for things without ever having to say from where it would come. So I very much commend your looking at the overall picture and the alternatives to address the issues that you've highlighted. Can I just take you back, Taylor? Are you, as an alternative to more money, the upfront solution. You talked about the distribution model. Can I just be clear, did you mean the distribution of existing college funds, or did you mean across wider education? And if so, from where would these monies be derived in the education budget?
Yeah, there is an opportunity to look at all these different categories, and you're absolutely right, redistribution. If we accept, for instance, as we're discussing, that there's a finite envelope, we know that within that. Schools, I am not expert enough or knowledgeable enough to probably presume to look in that aspect. It's a different environment there. So I would suggest I would focus on the higher education, or should I say university and colleges. I do think there's a philosophical debate of the investment between colleges and universities. Our models are different. There are different strains in universities that colleges don't have, and vice versa. However, I think there needs to be a review of the equity of the core funding distribution between universities and colleges based on impact. And that impact may come in various different categories, for example, social impact, community impact, economic impact. If I might, for example, one of the things that we are very passionate about at Glasgow Kelvin and driving forward is the agenda to training the new workforce for a sustainable world. We have a number of specialisations. I'll give you just one example to put that in context. It's HVAC, which is heating, ventilation and air conditioning. That is all going to change, definitely, not just domestically, but for business over the next few years. We're driving that forward. We are in the position to deliver that new workforce, working with colleges and universities through innovation, taking the country forward and the new technologies. Absolutely, of course, that is absolutely essential. But in my mind, we're losing focus on what we will need to establish is a large group of trained, highly trained individuals to deliver the new needs of the workforce going. And we are absolutely well positioned to do that. So again, redressing and looking, re-looking again about that distribution between university and college. I would say that between college and school is a much more complex discussion, and schools are a much more complex and different debate involved there. But however, I'm sure members have seen disparity per head of funding between schools, colleges and universities. I won't quote it off the top of my head because I can't do that, would be inappropriate of me, but it's quite startling.
Thank you. Sue, I know you don't want to come in, but I've got something specifically that I want to ask yourselves. You've mentioned about the expanding cost base that you're facing and that you have a clear financial plan to tackle the challenges that you're facing. And I suppose I'm trying to sort of unpick and find out, is that one of the reasons that's behind the forthcoming merger that you're looking to proceed with?
Thanks. It's one of the reasons, yes. We have a financial plan whether we merge or not, but merger is factored in, and we see merger as being one way of improving our long-term financial sustainability. But it's not just about improving our cost base or economies of scale, etc. It's about working with our partners in a way that that gives us a structure and a framework that is sustainable to go and pursue and achieve the opportunities that we all think are common to the three colleges, that on our own we cannot really pursue because we're too small, and we don't have the thought leadership, or we don't have the capacity with our staffing. By coming together, we will perhaps create bigger teams, ability to pursue new things. So it's about growth as much as improving our cost base. But for me, for UHI Outer Hebrides, the merger is part of the financial sustainability. I think we'll find it very difficult to keep going on our own.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that. I suppose following up then on the figures that Derek mentioned about 80% of the accessible revenue having to go to pay for staff, I'm going to move on to questions now from my colleague Ross Greer, please.
Thank you, Convener. I found Derek's evidence around the role of the Glasgow Regional Board really interesting, and Sue, I acknowledge that you're in quite a different situation across UHI, but And I'd be interested in your perspective on what the Lanarkshire Regional Board does that the individual institutional boards could not do. I accept it will do stuff that they don't do simply because it exists at the moment, but is there anything that it does that simply would not be possible to do on that individual institutional level?
In Lanarkshire, the regional board is also the board for New College Lanarkshire. So there are not two separate boards in that instance, and South Lanarkshire has its own board. So I'm not sure if I could really answer that question that you're asking for, because we don't have two boards that we work to.
Yeah, it's harder to disentangle that one, but the same debate comes up about whether or not that is an appropriate model of governance. Moving on to wider issues around industrial relations, I've got a couple more general questions about that, but just first, one specific one around local dispute resolution processes. So there was an NGNC agreement a couple of years ago now, I think, for each individual institution to agree a local dispute resolution procedure. I think at this point, most but not all colleges have. So just before I go any further to ensure questions are being directed properly, could each of you confirm if your college does have a local agreed dispute resolution process with your unions?
Derek first.
Yeah, I can confirm that we do have a dispute resolution process. The one caveat I would say, however, is not to conflate that with recently there's been discussion from Unison, which is a more detailed process that Unison wished to bring in when colleges move into a position of dispute, for example. But there is a structure for resolution of dispute. But the actual technical process, I beg your pardon, I'm conflating.
Anne or Sue?
Likewise, we have a process for dealing with dispute, but recently with enhanced communication, we are dealing with issues much, much more quickly and much more readily going forward.
Finally, Sue, over to you.
Yes, we have procedures in place. We don't have a written one with Unison, but that's being addressed at the moment. But we do with the IS. And with Unison, although we don't have a written procedure, we do have a procedure that we have followed as legacy.
In the interest of time, can we make sure these are short and sharp, if that's okay? Thanks.
And just one additional question for me then on industrial relations. In 7 of the last 8 years, we've seen national strike action. Some of that has come as a result of individual institutional disputes that have escalated. Others, it's because national bargaining disputes. Could each of you just give a brief contribution on why you think it has escalated to national action so regularly? Because there's no other sector in Scotland where we've seen national strike action almost every single year in the last decade.
Derek?
Potter, if I could go first. Most of the disputes have been around pay, essentially, and many of the local disputes have been associated with pressures of pay. And again, to go back to the classic point, is I happen to be one at the moment of two principals who are on the national as a negotiator on the joint group. Our restrictions have been, and the hub of or the cusp of industrial action are all related to our inability to meet the expectations. So, for example, at the last resolution, the reason it went on for so long is we got to a point of resolution in the end that was the absolute maximum we could go in affordability. Now we're moving into the realms, dare say, of almost impossibility. It's not technically possible for us, for example, to meet expectations that may be going on to 5% and 6% within that. And to be honest with you, as I've made the statement, the chronic continuous underfunding has made that an extremely challenging situation. And the vast majority of those pay increases will, of course, have been in part paid for in the reduction of the workforce and the cost of that.
Is there anything...
Sue wants to come in as well.
Just kind of briefly follow up with Derek just on that point. I'm interested in your experience then as an NGNC negotiator. Is there anything about the structure of the NGNC from your experience as a negotiator that you would change, accepting that the lessons learned exercise is still not ongoing, but the government's response is still yet to be published?
Yeah, I mean, I'm quite new to it, so I was in the middle of the review. So I think I was looking at it from a new eye. Yes, I think there are opportunities to look at structurally how things can be done more effectively. I do think there had been some cultural stereotypes within there that I think on turnover of staff perhaps is alleviating that. So there's no doubt that we in general, I think as a group, and I did, certainly did accept the last recommendation for the lessons learned and agree and support taking that forward. But I would say one of the biggest problems that we have is we are not in direct control of our budgeting, quite clearly, which you wouldn't expect. However, the constraints that we were describing are so tight that our ability to manoeuvre within that envelope is extremely constrictive. So it makes that negotiation extremely difficult, to the point often resorts to industrial action.
Can I bring Sue in now, please?
Thank you. I think Derek's covered all my points.
Thank you.
Very efficient. That's all
for okay.
me.
OK, all right. That's fine. Thank you very much. Just want to check now. Can we move to questions from Michael Mara, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to everyone for the, I think, pretty concerning evidence we've had so far today, but a lot of real clarity, I think, for all of us in terms mm-hmm. of some of the impact. So it's been very useful. I wanted to touch on some research that we have around completion rates that has been presented to us by our colleagues in SPICE in the Parliament. So there's a particular issue at the moment, it seems, post-pandemic, where pre-pandemic non-completion of courses was around about 24%. That's now risen to 28%. And I just wondered what the sector was doing to try and deal with those issues. Derek, first of all, that'd be fine. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. It's recognised throughout the sector there is a pattern there within it. The impacts of the college sector were very much locked down, even when society in general were not locked down. So we know there's been significant impacts. But to answer your question directly, I think Anne touched on it, for example, the extension, for example, of bringing the students and welcoming the students back is when I did my welcome back to the staff. Yes, there were a number of concerns within staff, but the big focus that I emphasised to them, the one thing that you must focus on, no matter if you're from the supporting the students or you're teaching the students or whatever your role is, no matter how small you perceive it is, you're all contribution towards the student experience. So from the minute they walk into the door, this is a new life for them. It's post-pandemic. We are anecdotally at the moment, because we don't have the figures in, and I wouldn't be quoting, the numbers of students and groups that are coming through appear to be quite positive, quite healthy. The feedback, preliminary feedback we're getting for students is very positive. So as far as their experience is concerned now, it sounds as if I'm just brushing over that. The amount of work and investment and time and energy in that is enormous. I could give you a technical example. What we've identified at our college, and I know other colleges have done in the past as well, is the working together of the teaching staff, for example, the course tutor, and centrally using data to identify, which we would say anybody, a student that may be at risk, early risk of withdrawing from the programme. And much of the time that is to do with personal finance, situation, could be mental health and so on and so forth, to make sure that we get bespoke and direct responses to them as soon as humanly possible, immediately, to then give them the support. The other phenomenon that we're very well aware of is, and particularly in young people that then transition to college, they have a group of support amongst the friends. And unfortunately, if one individual wavers and withdraws, then the individuals, it clicks in the head that they will then follow that. So we're very, very conscious of that. So it's absolutely up front, making sure when we recruit and we enrol, it's the right students getting in the right programmes as quickly as possible. I know it's classic points, but it's emphasising, make sure our systems and processes are absolutely up front and timely in doing that. And that's the first step. And the next step is obviously maintaining the quality and the continuous support for that student experience right the way through the programmes.
And the information that we have would seem to indicate, I'll maybe bring Sue in a second if she has further comments on that, that there's this increase in non-completion related to the pandemic. It would seem to be a problem, and it's great to hear that there's maybe some evidence that these things are being tackled. But those non-completion rates have remained, it would seem, quite high, goes far to say it's very high, for a very long period of time. I think it's quite difficult, I think, to draw the comparison, but the best information we have would indicate that in England, there's a far higher completion rate. Is that something that the sector recognises?
If I could expand a little bit my answer there, is obviously when I've been responding to you, I've been talking about there in reducing withdrawals, yes. So therefore retention. The reason I'm doing that is because we know retention is inextricably linked with the final success rate. So when we're talking about success rates and improving that, quite clear, that's why I went for that point. One element that I'm cautious, and I must be honest with members, my knowledge and understanding of the statistics in England are not good enough to give you an expert opinion. And the reason for that, I'm well aware that Scottish figures are based on FES, which is Further Education Statistics, which I'm very well versed on, very, very comfortable with. In universities, you can compare England with Scotland because it's HESA. England have a completely separate statistical system, and I've got to be honest, I have no idea what the parameters of an English college declaring success or achievement compared to Scotland. Mm-hmm. And if I could give you an example, the Scottish programme is very black and process is very black and white. Effectively, if you have a student that attends for 1 hour in the whole year, they enrol in the week, they attend for 1 hour, that goes down as an enrolled student, so therefore they appear on an unsuccessful student. There's a lot of debate and argument. Really, that was an individual making a decision early on. That is included in the Scottish statistic. I have no idea if it is in the English statistic. Another example that colleagues will probably give you examples on, students in programmes then gaining employment, that is a failure as far as the statistic for the Scottish Funding Council. I don't know if that's the same in England. Another example is a student studying, for example, plumbing, then gains employment and gets an apprenticeship. They transfer within the same college to an apprenticeship programme, and their original programme, they're a failure within that statistic. Now, I don't know if that's the same in England, so I'm loathed to make that direct comparison, but there's obviously some connection there. I find it difficult to reconcile the fact that I could have seen some of the English figures that are significantly higher. My instinct might tell me there needs to be a deeper dive into that to understand that you can get an equivalence between the two. But there's no denying we need to absolutely drive forward the success rates of our students, and they have suffered significantly over the pandemic. And at the moment, we're at stage one of that student experience and bringing that forward and ensuring they've got that face-to-face contact as well. Many of our students, in particular FE students, of which my college has a much larger proportion of FE compared to HE because of the nature of its college, they have been disproportionately affected. And you can imagine if you're in a practical subject or a non-advanced subject, you need that interpersonal contact. If you're a more mature and studied student that's on HNC, the digital environment was either survivable or you could actually even thrive potentially. In that.
Thank you. Sue, is that?
Yeah, I was going to say, can we hear from
Sue McFarlane?
Thank you. Yeah, I think Derek's touched on, you know, how we measure success, and we've got very rigid KPIs that we that measure our performance. And I think we need to have far more nuanced approach to that. As Derek said, it's seen as a failure if we lose students to employment. Now, it's about impact and whether we can correlate the, you know, what impact we've had in terms of their learning on their final destination, and whether that is something that the college has contributed to, rather than they just so happened to quit the course because they didn't like it and got a job regardless of their experience. I think there are two things. There's retention, which is one thing, and how do we retain students, because that's about their experience and what their, you know, why they want to stay with us or why they don't. I think there's the non-completion, though, which is, for me, it's the greater concern is people who stay with us right till the end and don't complete. And I think the colleges have been a lot around that in terms of looking at course design, looking at flexibility of learning. And we're doing a lot, I think, as a sector for those who do leave us to go into employment, to be able to have flexibility of delivery, that they can continue in their studies and gain their qualification, but they've actually left the full-time course, etc. So there's a number of things I think the sector have tried to do around flexibility of course design, flexibility of delivery. It's about the student experience. But I think underpinning that, we do have to have another look at how we're measuring success of our learners.
Anne, do you have any comments in this area?
Just very briefly, the decline in completion rates is disappointing. SQA, many of the awarding bodies did allow us to make alternative assessment arrangements, but for subjects that included health and safety, some practical skills, we were not able to use the alternative assessment methods, and those students had to carry units over to the next year, which has had an impact.
Okay, that's really useful as well, and very specific, I think. And I have a last question on this area, and I do have others on a separate area. This is around the widening access agenda. I think, Sue, your points in terms of how do we measure success in this regard. So one of my understanding of the widening access agenda is that this is judged by inputs, in essence, the number of students that are recruited, rather than those who complete. Would we be better talking, or at least in addition, talking about those that complete? Because when I've talked about non-completion, it's currently sitting at 27%. For those in the widening access cohorts, the lowest SIMDs, that soars to 36%. Now, we understand, I think, collectively, some of the reasons and the challenges around that. But in terms of how we understand success, would completion figures and reporting on completion figures for widening access be an appropriate metric to add?
I think it needs to be reviewed and defined, because, for instance, behind the suite of parameters that you'll be given, it depends on the question that's been asked, and sometimes the standard set that you receive probably doesn't answer your questions. And for example, I know that there is a suite of parameters that sit behind some of the statistics that you're referring to, that are more substantial, that might be more helpful. For example, we do have the statistics, it's per individual, per head. There are other statistics that are measured in credits, I won't go down there, but student volume of student activity and delivery, that gives you a different picture and a different message. So, for instance, in my college, we have a very high proportion of part-time. It can skew if you don't have the full breadth of information going forward there. But there's no doubt that having clear definition, if we have got policy questions to be answered, we should have, at a national level, a clear definition of what statistics track that. So, for example, we use SIMD as a measure too broadly. Mm-hmm. Perhaps it needs to be broken down, and there are lots of other data that sit behind that we all collect, but I would agree, I think it needs to be better defined to answer the specific questions and monitoring against policy.
Can I quickly ask Stephanie Callaghan to ask a question? There are other panellists may wish to contribute in response to Michael's question as well, if that's helpful, on this theme. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener. So just to touch on the wider issues around completion rates that Michael Maddis already mentioned there, quite a short question from me. I'm just wondering if there are actions that are specifically to address the issues around disabled students and care experience students being even less likely to successfully complete and more likely to withdraw.
Again, I can respond. Within our analysis, on a regular basis, quarterly, and obviously reported back to the Board of Management, for example, through learning and teaching, so it's monitored all the way through the process. But what we also do is have a comprehensive process of dynamic operational planning. So when we identify anomalies, sometimes the statistics are in a year in retrograde because you're looking back and then making adjustments moving forward. But for example, every single programme and every single course, and I think it will be the same at all colleges, have their course quality improvement tabulated down there, and there is a requirement to look at all related issues, be it for vulnerable groups or protected characteristics, and then again. So we look at statistically, and we're talking about achievement rates. Yes, we look at the breakdown of the protected characteristics, for example, and see how they are performing in comparison with the rest of the college. We do it wider with the rest of the country as well when we're looking at it, and that's looking retrospectively. So the mechanism... Sorry.
Are there direct actions then that you're taking to address that?
The way that that's directly actioned is at a college level, there is an operating plan, there's an evaluation, a curriculum review within that, but the expectation that it will be addressed explicitly by programme, that if a programme is identified that their cohort of students are perhaps following it, and there are interventions that can be put in place. So it's very, I think we're actually quite sophisticated in the way we monitor and ensure. Some of it will be at an institutional level, some of it will be local.
Please, Derek, I'm just conscious of the time, and I know Sue wants to respond to some of these, and perhaps Anne.
Quick comment.
Anne first, and then Sue. Okay, thank you.
Okay. In support of Fair Work, we need to ensure the increased prosperity and equity for all within our college community. COVID has had an uneven impact on certain groups, and one of the actions that we've taken in the college is we've set up a new department for access and progression to support individuals furthest away from the labour market and to support fair access and progression. So that's one of the actions we've taken in the last 12 months.
Finally, our last contribution from Sue. Thank you.
Thank you. Derek talked very much about how we monitor our performance against protected characteristics, but it's important to know that we actually plan against those, and you know, we have student engagement strategies and plans. We have widening access plans, and although we've not been required over the last couple of years to formally construct these or report on these, we do these as a matter of course in terms of our planning of, you know, how we support our students, not just in general, but for specific characteristics as well. So there's planning, there's monitoring, and there's funding that we set aside to ensure that, you know, we've got the right guidance, the right student support in place as well. So just wanted to mention that. Thank you.
No. Thank you very much. And so we've clearly had a very packed session there. And I just want to thank you all for your time and responding to the questions so in such depth and detail. We found it really important. So thank you for that. We are now going to have an 8-minute suspension to allow the change of witnesses. OK, so thank you very much. Okay, thank you. Welcome back. We will now take evidence from our second panel of witnesses this morning. Your microphone wasn't on, you're okay. I would therefore like to welcome Joanna Campbell, who's Principal and Chief Executive of Dumfries and Galloway College, Neil Cowie, who is Principal and Chief Executive of North East Scotland College, Angela Cox, Principal and Chief Executive of Ayrshire College, and finally Hugh Hall, Principal and Chief Executive of Fife College. As with our first panel, this too will be hybrid, as we have Angela Cox participating virtually. Angela, as you will not be likely to be able to catch my eye, when you want to come in, can I ask that you put a capital R in the chat box when you wish to speak or contribute, and the clerks will be monitoring the chat box, and I'll bring you in when I can. So now I would like to move to questions, and the first questions are from Graham Day. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. We've obviously gone through a process over the last decade which has involved merger and regionalisation. I wonder if you could briefly give us your views on the extent to which those processes have achieved their aims, what have been the successes, and where is there still room for improvement?
Okay, shall I answer that first? First of all, thank you for the invite to come along and provide evidence this morning, and I welcome the opportunity to represent Dumfries and Galloway College. In terms of the regionalisation process, as I said in my written evidence, I think it's worked well in Dumfries and Galloway College and Dumfries and Galloway Region from the point of view that it's increased our alignment to Scottish Government policy, and it's provided us a greater focus on advancing opportunity for the people within the region that we serve and also supporting economic growth. However, there's two points that I wanted to highlight to the committee where I feel that there's further work to do, specifically within my region. And the challenges of a rural economy are such that within Dumfries and Galloway region, we have 95% of our business base are SMEs. And therefore, unlike other regions in Scotland, there is no economy of scale. We've got a very diverse employer base, and therefore, I think I would describe the landscape as being slightly cluttered. Therefore, there's still work to do in terms of regional coherence. So for me, that's an unfinished matter, if you like, within the regionalisation process. And unlike other regions in Scotland, the college is not always the focal point in the way that other regions operate. And then the other aspect of regionalisation, which I feel we still need to address, and I know that in the previous evidence session you spent some time exploring that, is the funding challenges, particularly for rural colleges. Thank you.
Good morning, good to be here. I've been at Fife College for 5 years as principal, but prior to that I was the chair of Forth Valley College for 7 years, and I was one of the regional leads that actually worked on the regionalisation programme under the then Cabinet Secretary. So that gave me some insights into what was planned. And also, in a previous life, I worked at the Scottish Funding Council. I was one of the commissioning team back in 1992 when they created the Scottish Higher Education Funding Council. So I got a wee bit of understanding of where we've come from. I think regionalisation has achieved economies of scale. I think it's increased opportunities for our colleagues, our staff. It's actually helped us to improve our offering for our local employers, regional employers. And the whole thing actually ran very smoothly. It was delivered on time, and we managed to, as a piece of work, that bringing together disparate organisations, I think it achieved its aim of creating new regional colleges. It generated about £50 million worth of annual savings in the process. Unfortunately, all of those savings went back into the Scottish Government, so the colleges didn't get the benefit of the savings, which is rather unfortunate. And the other thing for me, which was the most damaging aspect of regionalisation, was the decision to take colleges into public sector control. and ONS, Office of National Statistics, classification became that of a public sector. So we suddenly became part of Scottish Government financial regulations and so on, with all the constraints and bureaucracy that accompanies that. Previously, we had not freedom to operate in as much as we could do whatever we liked. There were all the constraints that you would normally expect of a publicly funded organisation in terms of borrowing and so on. But all of those flexibilities were removed on regionalisation, and I think colleges have been suffering as a consequence of that ever since. The inability to borrow, for example, means that we are totally dependent on the Scottish Government for our capital infrastructure financing. The Scottish Government announced in 2014 there'd be two new colleges, one in Falkirk, one in Dunfermline. We're only now putting the foundations down in Dunfermline, and it's been painful to say the least. Had we been a university with the ability to borrow, we'd have been getting on with a lot of stuff like that. So lots of bureaucracy, lots of control, lots of constraints. So that's a real downside. So upsides, economies of scale and how we can work with employers, the opportunities for our staff. Downside is the straitjacket, which is ONS classification.
Thank you. And again, on behalf of Northeast Scotland College, I welcome the opportunity to meet with the committee and share my thoughts. It was interesting, having been working with the college for about, now 23 years, and been a public servant for about 34, and very much grounded in the Northeast, as is my family, and formerly a member of what was Banff and Buchan College pre-merger. I got to see and understand exactly the kind of role together you get when you bring two very big organisations into a merged state. And there are things that you will lose. And I think, certainly I think the legacy colleges were very, very different beasts. And so therefore, to actually kind of come together in one entity, one culture, one college, took longer than probably we all anticipated. Nonetheless, I do believe that we have achieved that. And I think that we have, through the three main campuses that we've been able to kind of keep going, and we've established communities that we serve in slightly different ways. But there's some genuine positive things that I think have come from the experience of regionalisation since 2013. I think that we've moved towards a more coordinated regional curriculum for the former colleges to deliver in one way. There certainly has been an enhancement around regional progression pathways, and I would like to kind of name check the two universities that we have, particularly Robert Gordon University, who we are quite closely aligned to in terms of progression, and that seems to work really, really well for a lot of our learners who wish to articulate degree programmes. But I would also say that we've got very, very good relationships. I think they've kind of forged even more strongly in terms of regionalisation with the two local authorities and the partner schools there in Aberdeen City and Aberdeen Shire. And consequently, I think that opens us up in better ways to be more accessible as a college for those pupils that are seeking to progress to us and from us and obviously into university. I think also there have been, there are certain things around staff development has been more coordinated, which has been really, really helpful. And again, I think there's some benefits to the estate that we have had where others haven't. For example, we've been able to capitalise on the Fraserburgh campus work that we had done pre-merger and add a STEM centre to that, which has been well used. And similarly, other things that I think have come as a consequence of regionalisation is strengthened the regional relationships, particularly around regional economic strategy, around the activities of one. You'll be currently aware of Energy Transition Zone and NESA. And that is forming things very, very well for our move towards energy transition. And I think community planning has become more solid, particularly in terms of Aberdeen City. And that means that we're more joined up in terms of our more dominant planning arrangements for the citizens of Aberdeen City. In terms of the drawbacks, I don't necessarily have an answer to this, but I expect the committee will want to explore this further as we talk. I think student attainment has taken a hit. And I think, and particularly in terms of larger colleges, there's a complex set of discussions, I think, to be had around why that is still the case, because that hasn't generally tended to improve. And pre-merger, the figures were certainly better in terms of where we were at in relation to some of the activities that my legacy colleges were involved in. And I think something, perhaps just briefly, though, the affinity to the college might have changed and be impacted as a consequence of regionalisation. I think colleagues in the legacy colleges were very, very connected to their own colleges. Having this new entity to work with and promote and work within was a challenge, I think, for a good few, particularly those in our rural centre at Fraserburgh. However, I think that we've worked very hard as a leadership team to make sure that we are promoting that one college ethos. And I think that is working in terms of our enhanced engagement approaches, particularly with our staff, our students, our stakeholders. Thank you.
Angela, can I ask you to respond as well? Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Just for some context, I joined Borders College 6 years ago after spending over 20 years in the English sector, and I've been principal of Ayrshire College for just over 2 weeks now. So my experience and examples will probably jump between the two. But for me, joining Borders College, you know, I had a really clear regional focus, being recognised as an anchor institution and being round the table with our local authority and other partners in terms of delivering on the priorities for the region was a real benefit, I think, to the socioeconomic prosperity of the region. I think for me, though, we also need to recognise the importance of the travel to work and learn patterns, depending on where you are and how that impacts on the economy. So for us, the economy in Edinburgh and Northumberland is just as important as the economy in the Scottish Borders. And all colleges will have a set of unique skills and capacity that can add value to a national agenda, if not international agenda. So if I think of some of the unique programmes we have, or I had in the Scottish Borders, around performance sport, HND, downhill mountain biking, the only programme in Europe, and we have more European students on that programme than we have local students. And if I look to AIR, our unique sort of aeronautical provision, we shouldn't lose sight of that. So that regional focus is very important, but we're part of a bigger framework, and that partnership working across that bigger educational framework in Scotland is critical. And I think building on those foundations, colleges need to have increased autonomy and the ability to be agile, to respond to the needs of the region and also those national economic priorities. And a performance framework which is focused on impact rather than activity, because sometimes the impact of what we do cannot be seen within 6, 9 and 12 months. And I think that's really important within that local and region piece, because often our focus is about community and engagement and not just about skills outcomes. Thank you.
Graham?
Thank you. You know, one of the aspirations of regionalisation was that colleges would end up with greater clout and greater status in terms of relationships with universities. And I'm just wondering, 10 years on, to what extent have we achieved that? To what extent do we have parity of esteem and genuine partnership working between equals?
Who would like to go first on that one? Oh, Neil. Yes.
Graham, from my perspective, I think we've worked well with our partner universities. I do think there's, without attempting to try and cheat any business away from them, I think there is some, you know, there is, it's still seen as a bit of a gold standard that you progress to universities, when I think actually in this day and age, with the raft of qualifications that we have and the pathways that we have, there are many options. I don't know necessarily nationally whether we've got that parity esteem with our university colleagues, but I certainly think that as a regional player, NESCOL does play alongside the universities and is supported to that end in ways that have probably elevated its status, I would have said, as a consequence of regionalisation. That's my perspective from my region.
Anyone else? Joanna?
Yes, I'm happy to answer that. So I think my experience of you know, working with universities is a particularly positive one. I think we have better alignment, if you like, with the post 92 institutions. Many colleges have extensive articulation arrangements with their local universities and further afield. Within my own specific context in Dumfries and Galloway, we are a partner on the Crichton Campus Leadership Group. The campus consists of a number of universities and the college being the biggest educational institution, not just in the region, but in the south of Scotland. And we are delighted to be one of the South of Scotland Pathfinder programme of work. And the specific project that relates to this is a piece of work we are doing with University of West of Scotland, where we're looking to create a coherent learner journey from the senior phase of school right up to graduate level. And I welcome that opportunity because it means that we can proactively plan progression from college to university that starts in the senior phase. So next year we will be offering two specific programmes, one in cybersecurity and one in business, and that's to create an even greater higher education offer in the south of Scotland in recognition to the fact that this is a significant gap within the provision in the south of Scotland. Thank you.
Angela has indicated that she wants to contribute as well. First, Hugh, if that's okay. Yeah. Angela?
Yeah, I mean, my experience in the Scottish Borders and at Ayrshire is that colleges are seen with the same parity of esteem by our local authority. However, not seen in terms of parity in terms of funding, where there is duplication in terms of those higher level technical skills, HNCs, HNDs, where universities are paid at a much higher level than colleges. And I'm not sure if this is a result of regionalisation, but certainly my experience in Scotland around that partnership working is really positive, and my example would be around the Edinburgh and South East City Region deal, where four universities and colleges have worked together for over 5 years in terms of delivering on that deal, and are now looking to where we go next and capitalising on the capacity and I guess trust that's been established between those institutions. So I think that's a really positive move. And all of that will only become a reality, though, if our funding and the controls, I guess, that are put on college are relaxed a bit, so that we can respond to the opportunities that are there to work in partnership with our university partners.
Over to you now, Hugh.
Well, I would say the direct answer is yes, it has strengthened our relationship with universities. It has improved the parity of esteem, if you like to put it that way. But for me, there are two big issues at play here that get in the way of perfecting that parity, and it is around funding. As Angela's just said, the funding sort of system in Scotland for tertiary education is a mess. It has been for a number of years. Everyone agrees that it needs to be sorted, but we've been talking about it for years and we've never actually done anything about it. It is totally and utterly irrational, the funding landscape, and it needs to be looked at as a matter of urgency. I think there's also for me an issue where people associate colleges with further education, but colleges are actually further education and higher education. If Fife College, 30% of our provision and growing is in higher education, and I think people forget that fact. And I think there is still this notion that when you're a parent or a teacher and so on, the ambition is to get to university rather than to get to college. And I think a lot of the fantastic work that colleges do is not seen. We're not great at blowing our trumpet and saying about all the wonderful things that are happening. We've got some fantastic students who, for one reason or another, will not go to university, want to go to the local college, quite often linked to vocational skills. They want to do a particular trade or something, or a modern apprenticeship and so on. And so getting the message out there that going to college is as good as going to university in terms of what your future progression might look like. I was at the state funeral on Monday at Westminster Abbey, and I was sat next to a guy with a green uniform on, and we introduced ourselves to each other. He was the chief executive of the North West Ambulance Service down in Manchester. It was just phenomenal just having a chat with him. We had plenty of time to spare to chat. And it transpires that he started his tertiary education in Carnegie College, a predecessor of Fife College. He didn't do well at school. He had schooled in Edinburgh, didn't do too well at school. Joined the NHS when he was 17. Got a posting when he was in early 20s to the Fife Ambulance Station. And after a couple of years, decided he wanted to study an HN, a Higher National in Management. Went to night school, picked up his Higher National, went on to Napier, got an MBA. He is now chair of the Ambulance Chief Executives Association for the whole of the UK. Really inspirational stuff. A couple of weeks ago, I met a guy called Clive Bellingham. He came into the college. He's the Vice President of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland, went off to university, lives in Kirkcaldy, went off to university, didn't like it, decided to go back home again, picked up an HN accounting at Adam Smith College, went on to become a Chartered Accountant, senior partner with PwC, and is about to become the President of the Institute of Chartered Accountants in Scotland. So those stories are significant, and there are a lot of them, and we really need to get out there and actually tell the story. I think when we do, then we'll start to get parity of esteem.
Thank you for those, Hugh. And we had one of your students, Alex Bryson, here, one of our previous sessions, who spoke very highly of the support and the opportunities that he gets as a late further education. But Stephanie Callaghan wants to come in on a supplementary, and maybe, Joanna, you might find scope to answer that one. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Fantastic story to hear from you there, Hugh. And really great as well to hear Joanna about that planning for the progression from college into university as well there. My question is around how colleges are engaging with the local businesses and sectors to grow the curriculum, particularly in the key areas that link with research and commercial opportunities such as renewables, engineering, etc. there.
Who would like? I think maybe perhaps with perhaps it being renewables, it might be.
I can answer that. Yeah. Joanna, do you want to go?
Or Joanna?
Okay. So I think going back to a point that was raised earlier, I think that regionalisation has allowed the college to be a key regional partner, and consequently, it means that we are more at the table now in terms of regional economic strategy discussions, and in terms of our links to some of the employers that would be looking to facilitate, for example. Energy transition activity, we can do that through the member organisations that we're affiliated to that would include, for example, Energy Transition Zone, the Regional Economic Strategy Group, and also the Northeast, or the National Skills Accelerator, Energy Skills Accelerator. And that gives us a conduit to some of the bigger players in terms of the industries that are quite common in the Northeast. But what we also do, I think, through and pretty effectively as a college, is that through things like the Flexible Workforce Development Fund and through our activities, okay, including our modern apprenticeships offer, we have a lot of links into a lot of employers for the Northeast. And what we've seen, even though it took a big hit, as you'd understand, through the COVID years, what we've seen is that we've grown that activity back. And so, you know, for example, modern apprenticeship numbers had dropped quite a bit during the two COVID years, but have now picked up substantially and encouragingly. And similarly, you know, our allocation of Flexible Workforce Development Fund and our spend of it is significantly higher than what it was pre-COVID. So again, I think what we're getting from a college perspective is that buy-in from employers. We're certainly getting the connections right in our region, and people are aware about what the college does and what it can offer. And I think that's encouraging. I don't know whether, Joanna, you wanted to say anything.
Yes. So just to build on the point that Neil made, certainly over the last 12 months, I have seen an increase in the number of employers that we've been able to support through the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. At Dumfries and Galloway College, we've had roughly a 25% increase in the number of modern apprenticeship places that we've been able to provide employers with. Most colleges run a number of fora, if you like, where their employers are able to engage directly with the colleges. And that allows us to develop curriculum that responds to what the employer's immediate need is. One of the things that we're really keen as a sector to do is to support that move towards micro-credentials. So there's an agility that exists within college curriculum that our awarding bodies do not necessarily keep at pace with. So what colleges are doing is they're able to offer upskilling and retraining provision and accredit that and award it themselves. And that's something that we're keen to do more of. You will have, if you've read the Funding Council's report, you will see that that is one of the recommendations. In terms of Dumfries and Galloway region, we have been working very closely with our local authority. I mentioned the Crichton Campus Leadership Group as well. And in response to the challenges around net zero, we developed a Green Skills Academy a couple of years ago, and we've been working with employers and our local authority to look at training in specific aspects of that particular area. So, for example, supporting electric vehicle maintenance, looking at wind turbine operative training, a whole, you know, lots of different offers there. And the result of that is that we're now able to support the move towards a decarbonised economy. And also this features as part of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation as well. Can I go back to a point I was going to make about parity of esteem? So there was two aspects of that I wanted to come back on. The college sector offers approximately 26% of our intake on an annual basis. They progress on to university study. So that means that a quarter of all students that come into the college sector every year are effectively doing year one or year and year two of degree. So the reason I'm telling you this is there is parity of esteem, but actually there's also duplication in the funding. So there is an anomaly in the SAS fee that the colleges receive in comparison to the fees that the universities receive. And there's also overlap in that funding. So if you're looking at efficiencies in terms of the public purse, then I would, you know, there's further opportunities there.
Draw our attention to that.
But yes.
So Angela wants to come in, and then also Hugh, and then we'll move on to questions from Oliver Mundell. Okay. Angela.
Yeah, so first of all, my experience in Borders, you know, a very small college in terms of the Scottish landscape. We worked with around 500 employers a year. The vast majority of them are small and micro businesses who really look to colleges to support their workforce development and innovation, although often colleges don't recognise innovation as it is. I'm also a trustee or a board member of Interface, and all the funding and measurements and focus around innovation sits within the university sector. So as we progress and the need for our small and micro businesses to be sustainable and grow in line with the NSET strategy, colleges need some capacity and funding to develop that innovation offer that we currently provide through our current funding mechanisms. And in terms of renewables, I think a really good example of where colleges have been agile is Borders College was given a significant chunk of community renewal funding to develop a sustainability academy. And we were able to provide training for over 500 people over the last 12 months on sustainability programmes, a whole different range of programmes for individuals and businesses. And the reason that was so important for us was because we weren't constrained by a qualifications framework. we could develop short 3-hour programmes, 9-hour programmes. It could be online, it could be in person. And it was very, very much tailored to what individual businesses and individuals needed. And without that funding, we wouldn't have been able to do that as an organisation, because our funding, it was all allocated through different funding lines.
Thank you, Angela. And Hugh Hall.
Colleges are at the heart of economic development within the regions we work with, and listen very carefully to employers across the region. It's one of the strengths, as I say, of regionalisation. I think that's given us status and the ability to go in there and give a good offering to those employers. And we also work with local authorities and their economic development operations and so on. So that aspect is working well. The government are pushing very hard on work-based learning, pushing things like foundation apprenticeships, graduate apprenticeships. We've seen quite an increase in the demand for modern apprenticeships over just the last year. But unfortunately, again, the funding landscape doesn't actually fit with this push for greater work-based learning. We're getting signals that the Flexible Workforce Development Fund is actually going to be reduced in the coming years, which seems very counterintuitive. There's about £2 billion spent each year by the Scottish Funding Council and by Skills Development Scotland on colleges and universities. That's a core grant. The funding system hasn't changed in a good number of years. Skills Development Scotland are focused on apprenticeships and other work-based learning type activities. The Funding Council is core grant, which is actually related to legacy funding. I hope at some stage someone will take the decision to bring Skills Development Scotland and the Scottish Funding Council together at the same time as we look at the whole funding landscape and actually have a funding landscape that actually aligns with what the economic development needs of the country actually are, and are not just simply legacy funding arrangements.
Lots of nodding heads there. Can we now progress on to some questions from Oliver Mundell? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I think the witnesses have already touched on a lot of the topics that are of concern to me, particularly around the challenges facing smaller rural colleges. And it's just a note from Joanna Campbell's written statement, the impact of flat cash, the pressures of inflation, and you know, some of the things that colleges have been asked to do. And it's really just to ask, I mean, how the kind of lack of funding is going to impact on your work over the next few years.
Thank you, Convener. Would you like me to answer that?
Sorry, I was speaking to my Vice Convener, Joanna. Sorry, I've missed that. Carry on.
Okay. So the challenges of the rural economy are such that it's difficult to achieve the same efficiencies that you would find in the larger colleges, and predominantly because we're dealing with smaller cohorts of students. But in terms of the funding challenges going forward, so we have flat cash for the next 5 years, and I know you had representation in the last evidence session with regards to this. Whilst I wouldn't want to put a quantum on what that looks like, what I can say from my college's perspective, what I can say to you is that it presents a significant challenge for us in terms of financial sustainability in the next 5 years. I think the need to work in partnership with other public agencies within the region is even greater than ever. And in my introductory remarks, I spoke about a cluttered landscape in Dumfries and Galloway region. And essentially, I think what I would like the committee to appreciate is that actually there is a need to drive greater financial sustainability by reducing overlap within that system, if you like, within my particular region. But going back to the question that you asked there, you know, it's harder for a small rural college to generate additional income in the way that it is for some of the larger colleges, predominantly because of the makeup of the employer base that we are working with, and also because a rural economy has lots of small employers, but not necessarily large employers, where you would perhaps be having a whole cohort of modern apprentices. We are dealing with lots of individual businesses. So, you know, that's another challenge that we have to address and we deal with.
I'm not sure if anyone else wants to come in. You have... Oh, Angela does, sorry.
Angela,
Yeah, coming from the borders, I would absolutely echo that. But what I would say in the very short time I've been in Ayrshire College, the real risk colleges in the current funding climate is our inability to do what we're really brilliant at, and that is around that sort of fair access and inclusive growth. And so, you know, Ayrshire is a large college, but we do have rural economies surrounding us, and to reach out to those most vulnerable within isolated communities, and that can sit within an urban setting, will become increasingly hard because we won't have the flexibility in our funding to offer something very bespoke to those individuals. There's a risk that everything becomes a bit mainstream. And I think that's the richness and uniqueness of colleges, in that we are inclusive organisations and we offer something for everyone within the communities that we serve.
Okay. Yes, yes. I'm pausing because I'm not getting any eye contact with all of our rounds. Needing supplementary. Can I interrupt for a second? We've got a tight schedule this morning, and we've got four panellists, so perhaps from questions going forward, if we can direct them to specific panel members. And if someone really wants to contribute, they can then catch my eye. Okay, over back to Oliver Mundell, though.
Thank you, convener. I just wasn't wanting to cut people off. The other kind of question I had, it came up in the previous panel in Glasgow, you know, where there'd been significant mergers of colleges around regionalisation. Obviously, that's more challenging and I would say impossible in some parts of the country, you know, just because of geography. But do you think that there's pressure within the system to look at sort of, I mean, what I would say was unsuitable kind of mergers or significant changes within the structure of colleges, you know, to try and deal with budgetary pressures? Do you think we're at that point? And again, I'm happy to put that open to anyone.
Hughes indicated yeah. He's willing.
So, I mean, the financial outlook for colleges is not good. That's everybody, I think, acknowledges that. I'm an accountant, though, so you just give me a set of figures and I'll come up with the answer you're looking for. Colleges have got great assets, brilliant people, infrastructure, terrific infrastructure and so on. And what we need to do is be able to maximise that. So if our core funding is being cut, then allow us the ability to innovate, be creative, get out there and actually earn additional income. But we can't do that because of the constraints of ONS classification. So if ministers want to help us solve our financial challenges, then they could do that very, very quickly. The Coherence Review had a number of recommendations, which again I think would be very helpful if we actually accelerate taking those recommendations forward. And it's really disappointing. That report was published in June last year. The Minister responded in October last year, and we're going to have to wait till next summer to get the statement of intent from government. We are in a crisis situation. We need the statement of intent now. We need the constraints removed to allow us to move forward. I think also there's going to be some structural change. I think it's almost inevitable. I don't think there's a geographic issue here. You can have campuses in far-flung areas. There's a merger going on in the Highlands, and they're very distant rurally. Heriot-Watt University have got campuses all over the world. You know, so I think we've got models that we can look at. But I think there will be further structural change, and I think it will come through the very strong relationships at colleges and universities. universities already have. And we're not talking here necessarily about mergers. There are different models that we can adopt, and we can look to other countries at how they operate their tertiary education system. You look to America, you look to Japan, you look to Australia, they have federal models of delivery. So I, as Fife College, will remain Fife College. You will not lose that brand, but I'll be working with several other institutions, universities, colleges in the delivery. So that gives you economies of scale. It helps tremendously in the removal of duplication. It brings your academic colleagues together to actually enhance the programmes we provide. It gives you a much stronger seat at the table when you're talking to government and local authorities and businesses and so on. So there will be further structural change within the sector. I think it will involve colleges and universities. But we need government to come out and exercise a bit of leadership and direction at this time so that we're not pushing further down the road for solutions at a point in time when, you know, we've already had to lose jobs and everything else. I'm a believer that we shouldn't be losing jobs, we shouldn't be shedding jobs. Why would you want to do that? We should actually be growing the businesses that we have.
I think Willie Rennie has a short supplementary.
Why doesn't government get this?
No, that's short.
I don't know. I think you may want to put that question to government ministers. It's not for the want of asking, on my part. So they feel they need to take the time to do it. But I think that's a matter for questions. But I really do want to underline the need for some urgency here. If we were a corporate, if we were any other business, you would be around the board table. You would be making decisions based on the evidence in front of you, and you would be getting on with it. We are not getting on with it.
If government doesn't seize the opportunity?
I think there'll be issues for quite a number of institutions around their financial sustainability. I think there'll be need for bailouts. I think there'll be job cuts that were perhaps very avoidable. I'm hoping that none of that's going to happen at Fife College, because regardless of what the government are going to be doing, I'm not waiting to be telt. I'm getting on with it, but I would find it much better if I have the government alongside me, working with me to come up with solutions. And there are lots of options that we could be exploring, and we need to get on with it.
Neil Cowie?
Just to add to what Hugh is saying, I think that, you know, I think we've been very, very progressive since regionalisation kicked in, and I think we've sought to do, you know, and meet national and regional priorities as best as we could. The concern I think that we all have is that, you know, the day-to-day operations of our colleges are becoming trickier because we are already very lean, and regionalisation saw that in terms of the amount of efficiency savings we had to make in order to merge colleges together and embrace the regionalisation ambition. But there's a national strategy for economic transformation, and fundamentally there's some big asks in there, and I think all the themes within that apply to the college. The skills one has been singled out as the colleges one, but it's not. I think we fit into all of those themes. And to have that delivered within the 10 years of the proposed strategy strategy is almost impossible to understand how that's going to be achieved in the current funding climate.
I know Michael Mara has some questions on that thread that will pick up ever so slightly in the future, but I'm going to move to CoCab Stewart first. If you can direct your question to a member of the panel. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I went on the college finances with the previous panel, but a lot of that has been covered. But my observation is that, you know, you won't be surprised to know that I have some sympathy with your position that you're having to work within a finite budget, which is being impacted by the cost of living and inflationary, and you can't borrow. So I do know that that's a tricky situation to be in. However, Hugh, you talked about the Office for National Stats that has created as a public body. So I'm assuming that by being a public body, that increases the accountability that sort of like colleges have. So I'm just looking for solutions of moving forward. And if you were to vary the business model, the funding model, how would you balance the accountability versus colleges having a little bit of extra space to be able to self-fund as well?
Hugh?
I don't think being non-ONS classified, if you like, so we still be a publicly funded body. For most of us, that equates to about 80-90% of our funding coming from the Scottish Government. That comes with all manner of constraints and requirements and so on. So, you know, the ONS classification is just a particular issue within government accounting, and ministers took a very conscious decision back in 2014 to allow that ONS classification to take place. It was within their gift not to go down that road. I struggle to understand the benefits to the Scottish Government of having colleges ONS classified. No one has ever explained it to me. And any of the risks associated with governance and accountability and so on are easily taken care of through the annual financial memorandum and accounting arrangements and so on. I can't see a downside. I can only imagine it's philosophical, but if you are getting the opportunity to speak to ministers, maybe you could ask them the question, because I'm puzzled.
Okay. Yeah, that classification does across the whole of the United Kingdom, though, isn't it? It's not just in Scotland that it applies.
My understanding is that ONS colleges in England are not ONS classified, but I could be wrong in that, but my understanding is that they're outside classification.
Perhaps, Angela, you worked south of the border before you came up to Borders in Ayrshire? Just for confirmation?
Colleges in England have a lot more autonomy and flexibility around how they generate income, take loans in terms of investment, and retain any profits or reserves they might have so that they can invest in future years. So there is much more flexibility to operate as a business and plan longer term than perhaps we're able to do in Scotland.
Thank you.
I just had a quick one. It was just about to ask whether what the impact was of multi-year funding. Has there been, maybe Joanna would like to come in on that?
So obviously we operate on an annual basis. Our funding's allocated on an annual basis. But if we were to move towards a multi-year funding arrangement, which of course is a college sector we've been pushing for, then that means that we'd be able to plan on a longer time frame. And it would mean that we were able to undertake pieces of work that lasted longer than perhaps one academic year. Going back to the point that you asked about declassification, for the college sector, it means that we're able to reinvest those surpluses. So multi-year funding deals along with declassification would mean that we would be able to reinvest that into our estate. If you followed the most recent Audit Scotland report, you'll see that there is a huge amount of backlog maintenance that the college estate requires. And the ability for us to address that without investment is significant. Multi-year funding deals along with declassification would make a significant impact on allowing us to address that going forward.
Thank you. And now can we move over to questions from Michael Mara, please?
Thanks, Convener. And I want to take us back to this, the statement of intent. It strikes me that this is in response to the review of coherent provision and stability, sustainability in the tertiary sector. But there's also a plethora of other documents and plans that have been, or suggestions that have been produced in recent years. Can I ask if any of the four of you have been involved in discussions around what the statement of intent might include?
Shaking heads.
No. Okay, that's useful and interesting. It's also my understanding that there is a group of in excess of 20 civil servants working around this area in St Andrew's House or some Scottish Government office somewhere. But there's also another group of civil servants essentially working in the Scottish Funding Council working on this same area to try and produce some kind of... do you have any insight into the process that might be followed? I mean, you're all leaders in this sector. You all bring the experience to the table. Any insight into how the government's making these strategic decisions? No. Okay. No. I mean, I think it's quite concerning, convener, on those levels. So I also wanted to put to a little bit of the what we heard from the previous panel. I mean, we had pretty concerning, to say the least, I thought quite devastating evidence from the principal of Glasgow Kelvin College saying that he's projecting he's going to lose a quarter of his workforce as a result of current cuts that are being brought through. Have you had the opportunity to feed those kind of headwinds, if we could use that euphemism, into the process about what might happen? Has there been any opportunity for you to input those kind of issues?
We're all currently finalising our financial forecasts for the Scottish Funding Council, which are due in at the end of this month. So we've all been in the thick of it. That's separate to our budgetary arrangements and our plans that we put to our board and so on. This is a kind of high-level view of what the next 5 years are going to look like financially. The Scottish Funding Council provide us with a list of assumptions in preparing those, which are totally and utterly removed from reality. You know, inflation at 2%, that type of thing. And so, under some pressure from the colleges, the finance directors of the colleges come up with a separate set of scenarios which we all felt were much more realistic. I mean, given the volatility in the economies at the moment, it's a difficult thing to do is to actually get any sort of clarity around financial forecasts. So those mechanisms are in place, and certainly speaking for Fife College, we've got a third scenario which we think is actually much more realistic than the other two. So we've now finalised that. It's going to my board next week. It's actually going to the Finance Committee tomorrow afternoon to review it. So we're still going through that governance process, and I think it would be inappropriate for me to get into any detail on that. But one of the things it does look at is headcount reduction. But it also looks at other things like opportunities for growing your commercial income, opportunities to take out non-salary costs and so on. And, you know, I think for all colleges, we want to minimise, if not avoid, reductions in staffing. None of us want to do that. It is very much a last resort. But I think it's too early to say what the sort of percentages would be. It's going to be tough, which is why I think we've got to think out the box, work across colleges and universities, come up with scenarios where we minimise the number of job losses. Although there will be people who will want to leave colleges because they get to an age and stage where they want to move on. And I think that's also an issue. When you look at the profiling of ages within colleges, I mean, 50% of my workforce are over 50. And I'm not making an ageist comment there. I'm one of them, we need to understand that people will move on and so on. But we want to try and avoid job losses as far as we are.
Is it your expectation then that these documents that you're producing, critical as they are, that they will inform the reform process that the SFC is undertaking? Is that your expectation?
Well, one would hope so. When we put these scenarios down in black and white and we say, here are all the different issues that we are now faced with, the Funding Council will then take that to the Scottish Government, and hopefully that will then, I suppose, underscore the degree of urgency about all of this. And ministers will then make decisions on the back of it. As you say, there's been a lot of reports in the college and university, more reports than you can shake a stick at. We don't need any more time for deliberation. All of the evidence is there. What we need now is leadership and decision-making.
Yeah, and I think we hear that.
Can I bring Angela in to respond to your questions, Michael?
Angela?
I'll not repeat a lot of what Hugh has said, but I think we need to be mindful that over 70% of the funding in the sector currently goes into pay. So there's not an awful lot of room for colleges to make those efficiencies and within the current constraints to grow our provision. So if the level of reductions or increase in costs are realised over the next 3 to 5 years, then it's inevitable that there will be people losing their jobs across the sector. And we've been set a list of scenarios from the SFC, which is based on flat cash, but also public sector pay policy, which is at 2%. Well, you know, inflation sitting at 10%, so colleges will have to likely find some funding to support a pay claim, if we're to give a pay claim at all. We've got increase in energy costs. You know, we all have big buildings, expensive buildings, and we deliver a lot of technical qualifications, which are expensive to run. When I was leaving Borders, our budget for construction consumables had already been nearly used up for the year, just in the increase in resources for the year. So there's real and immediate challenges there, but the scenario planning is difficult because what we've been provided from the SFC is at odds from where we think it will end up. But when staffing is at over 70% of our cost base, there's not much room for manoeuvre.
Joanna wants to come in as well.
Oh, please. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Convener. Just to build on what Hugh said, it's time to think outside the box. It's time to look across the post-16 educational landscape and ensure that we have, value for the public purse. Certainly within my region, there are a number of public sector agencies that are focusing on skills. From my point of view, colleges are at the heart of economic recovery and are best placed to focus on skills for their regional economy. For me, what I have been planning in that financial scenario is about creating headroom for growth. My operating budget is quite small in comparison to some of my colleagues who joined me on the panel today. But nonetheless, for me, there are significant savings that will need to be made going forward. 74% of my costs relate to staff, and the majority of those staff costs are teaching staff. So there's very little wriggle room for me to reduce those costs even further. We're running a very efficient curriculum offer. We have flexibility in how we offer our programmes, but there's very little capacity to be able to respond in a way that doesn't mean that we will have to look at our workforce. I don't want to give a quantum on that because, obviously that's an ongoing discussion with my board and my senior team.
We've got Neil also wanting to come in, Michael.
Please, just to reinforce a message here, we've done, as other colleagues have done too, we've done some modelling in terms of the FFR that's to be returned to the SFC. And with the assumptions that have been given, if we actually take our own assumptions, which would include inflation, pay and other increases in things like gas and electricity, it would quadruple what we're anticipating in terms of a possible deficit. And we've already planned through voluntary severance some reduction in staff for 22-23, but that was on the basis of our original deficit position or balanced budget and the deficit of far less. So consequently, if we're going to have to quadruple that loss of staff by four, that is going to be significant. And I want to restate a point that was made earlier on, in that that then makes the day job far, far more difficult. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And therefore outcomes and support for learners will be challenged. But if we are then to do the day job and meet the ambitions of, for example, the strategy, the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, I think that's going to be nigh on impossible unless there's some fundamental change in the approach to how colleges are funded.
Thank you, Neil. Michael, you've got one brief.
Well, I think this context in terms of the current operational context is very important when we're reflecting on this. I mean, so we took evidence last week from the SQA regarding the outcomes, and I was keen to understand issues of lost learning. So students who have had the reduced curriculum, who have not had the experiences they might have had. And Robert Quinn said in response to one of my questions, I feel strongly the college sector should be well placed to provide support. Have the SFC asked you to give any indication of what additional support you can provide to make up for lost learning? Any point?
I'm happy to answer.
Joanna, yes.
So we had a quantum of our funding that was ring-fenced for deferred student places. So those were students who hadn't been able to complete their studies in the last academic year. We had that the year before as well. So there's been a little bit of headroom there to allow those students to complete. I guess one of the difficulties that we faced over the course of the last 2 years was when dealing with the impact of COVID, we needed to respond very quickly in how we were able to allow our students to complete. Now, some of those students have elected to leave the college system to go out into employment.
If I can, sorry, John, I'm referring, I suppose, to the results this year. So this is, I think it's very relevant to some of the operating conditions that you find, but any indication that there's any form of resource or expectation of support for the cohort that is leaving school this year, who've just received their grades, coming into college, starting this week, last week, mm-hmm. that you're making up for those losses of learning? Is that being quantified? Is it being measured by SFC? Or is that being appreciated, that you're being expected by the SQA to do that work? No indication.
It can be a very succinct yes or
yes
no
or
answer.
Yes or no would be useful.
It's no from me, but my colleagues may
no.
disagree.
No. And Angela, is that a yes or a no from you?
It's a no for me, but okay. I also want to add it's not just about lost learning, it's about the development of social maturity, and it's about dealing with the mental health fallout of those young people and adults, yeah. actually, which will contribute to an increase in dropout.
Thank you. Thank you, Angela. Thank
That's
you,
great. Thank you, Michael. And now we've got a supplementary on this theme from Graeme Day, please.
Thanks, Convener. Joanna Campbell, I think you said a moment ago that 70% of your costs went on staffing. I think earlier today we heard of another college where it was 80%. But the latest figures available for universities, which are from 2019, suggest that the average spend on staffing is 55%. Now, that at face value is quite a discrepancy. I was wondering, from your position, whether that is a like-for-like comparison, because you'll accept that as quite a difference.
Yeah, sorry.
Lights on.
Yes, it is quite a difference, but colleges and universities are very different institutions from, you know, if you look at their balance sheets. We don't have the ability to generate a surplus, as we've heard already. We also aren't engaged in research activity in the same way that universities are, and therefore it stands to reason that our staff costs are going to be significantly higher. The other thing I would add to that, from a rural perspective, over the course of the last number of years, as we've gone through harmonisation in terms of our pay for our lecturing staff, I mean, it's fantastic that we've been able to harmonise those terms and conditions. However, from a rural point of view, that has meant that our staff costs have gone up quite significantly because, you know, in the process of harmonising those pay scales.
But that would suggest it's their ability to create income that's the difference here. That's what's set, creating the discrepancy. Is that the case?
I think there's a whole variety of reasons for it. You know, when you take into account that most universities are research intensive, so a lot of the costs would be associated with, for example, research and knowledge exchange projects, which don't necessarily have a high staffing input. I think that could be one factor. And also the nature of the spend is right. If you look at the profile of the commercial revenues versus the publicly funded revenues of a university, it's starkly different. But you also just need to walk around, as I suspect MSPs do, universities and colleges to see that they're very distinctly different in many ways. And I think much of that's to do with the fact that you know, universities generate a lot of revenue from international students. In fact, that is where they make the biggest margins. It's not on research, it's actually on international activity. But they also, as we've mentioned earlier, get a higher unit of resource for higher education than colleges do. And that's anomalous, and hopefully will be addressed. And I'm not suggesting for a minute we reduce the unit income for universities. I think this is a case of levelling up colleges so that we can provide the same sort of facilities that for a college student as they would get for, you know, when they attend a university. So there's a lot of unpacking to do in your question. And I think I want to go away and do some analysis. It must be the accountant in me that's coming through.
Well, perhaps write back to the committee on that.
Well, that's fine. Maybe I should declare an interest as an ex-employee of ICAS. But anyway, can I hand over now to questions from Ross Greer to the panel? Thank you, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Hugh, I was really interested in what you said a couple of moments ago around the relationship between SDS and the Funding Council, and obviously there was a pretty scathing report about how dysfunctional that relationship has been recently. But it seemed that you were suggesting essentially a merger of those two organisations because of that overlap. Just to clarify, I mean, that would create quite a large public body. Are there specific functions of SDS that you think would better sit with the SFC or vice versa? Or are you proposing that wholesale both organisations and all of their responsibilities, everything from the National Careers Service to apprenticeships to university and college funding, should all sit under one public body?
And I've got to declare an interest here because I was actually the lead person at Scottish Enterprise. I was the chief financial officer at the point of creation of Skills Development Scotland. So I had a lead role because we took what was Career Scotland and took it in, and all sorts of other changes happened at the same time. I suppose I was particularly keen to look at the funding aspects of it, the skills aspects of it. It's that part where I think there's scope for much greater alignment, much greater convergence, a lot of creativity around the nature of the funding, much stronger work-based learning type activities, and so on. I think it's open to discussion about what we do with the careers aspects of Skills Development Scotland. I think there's scope for economies of scale by bringing the two organisations together, as well as making them more impactful and effective. So I think it's all up for review, and I don't think there has, you know, this has been talked about again for quite a number of years, but I'm not aware of any deep dive study to look at the real benefits that would come from joining those two organisations together.
Thanks, Arch. That deserves further explanation in this Parliament, whether it's by ourselves or perhaps the Economy Committee. I've got a couple of questions for across the panel on industrial relations. And for the first, I'd appreciate if everybody were able to answer, because it's just a point of clarification. There was an NGNC agreement a couple of years ago around local dispute resolution processes and having each college agree to that dispute resolution process. That's with EIS. There's obviously a separate situation for support staff. I'm aware that I think at this point a majority, but certainly not all colleges, have that local process agreed and in place. Can I just check with each panellist what the status is at your institution? If maybe I go along the panel in person and then to Angela, if we start with you.
Yes, we have that in place at Fife College.
Thanks. Joanna?
We are currently in discussions with our LGNC about a matter that they have raised under that circular, and we will go through the local arrangement before, and hopefully it won't be referred to the National Committee.
Thanks very much. Sorry, just to briefly follow that up, do you have an indicative timescale for when you hope to reach a resolution on that?
I can't give you an answer on that at this committee, but it's not, we're not talking months, it's more likely to be weeks. But the LGNC is actually due to meet tomorrow, so that's why I can't give you a firm answer on that.
Great, thank you. Neil?
Ross, from my perspective, to my knowledge, we have it in place. I was in an LGNC meeting very recently where we had agreed that it would be reviewed imminently. So that is in train.
Thanks. And Angela?
Yes, so from Ayrshire's point of view, we did have an LGNC agreement in place for both our trade unions. Recently, Unison have raised some queries around that, and there has been an alternative model put to Unison, and we wait. But hopefully that will be resolved fairly soon.
Thank you. And Angela, if I could stay with yourself for my next question, because I'm interested in your perspective, having been elsewhere and now in the Scottish sector. We've, in 7 of the last 8 years, we've had national industrial action. Clearly, industrial relations in the college sector are not what anybody would want them to be. I'd be interested in your reflections on that comparative to your previous experience elsewhere. Do you think it's something unique to the Scottish sector that we can resolve, or is it unique to the time period that we're in and wider public finance constraints that we've ended up where we are?
So I can only go on my experience, and others may have different experiences depending on the colleges they're in. Coming from City of Liverpool College, obviously a huge focus on trade union involvement and negotiation, going through very big transformational change there, and was involved in that trade union striking on more than one occasion. I have to say my experience in Scotland is locally. I have had really positive and collaborative relationships with our trade unions. I've not experienced anything that would be out of kilter to what I've had in my experience in the English sector. But I do think there's a little bit of a disconnect in terms of some of the national narrative and what is happening on the ground locally within colleges. I think it's something we need to work through, and it's to do with national bargaining and how perhaps our trade unions position themselves in terms of national bargaining.
Got Hugh and then Neil also want to come in on this, Ross.
Please do.
Yeah, I also wanted to distinguish between what's happening at a national level and what's happening at a regional level. And I read the evidence session that Stuart Brown and colleagues gave, and Stuart's a friend of mine. And you know, some of the language around lack of trust and some of the antagonism around that may be a feature of national bargaining from time to time. It certainly isn't a feature of the relationships we have at a regional level, which I would describe as very cordial. We work very closely together. We give advance sight of what's going on. There's regular meetings that take place on all of the big issues. Some of the stuff we've been talking about this morning about the financial forecast and so on. I've got a workshop on Monday with Unison and the EIS reps in the college, where we're actually going to talk through all of the issues and so on. So regionally, I think industrial relations are very positive, very strong. I think nationally, it didn't get off to a great start when national bargaining was introduced by the Scottish Government. And I think there's been lots of bumps on the road and so on, some of which I would say very, very avoidable. And I think we need to learn the lessons of the last several years and maybe have a wee rethink around how we deliver on the national bargaining aspects. And there's been several reports that you'll be aware of that have been written on this, lessons yes. learned and so on. You know, at the end of the day, it's actually about people. And it's about getting the right people around the table who are you know, committed to making things work for the good of the college sector. And I know Stuart Brown and other US colleagues have got that very much at the forefront. So we'll share that aim to do what's best for the college sector. And I think getting around the table and actually working through some of these issues is what we need to do.
Neil?
From my perspective, Ross, I would echo what's already been said by Angela and by Hugh. I think that it was pleasing to note within some of the submissions for this committee that union colleagues recognised there was actually good practice, even though they were focused very much on where there wasn't. And I do think it's not rocket science. I think it's also about really positive relationship building. And you know, from the get-go, when I came into post, and I came into post on the 20th of December 2019, although I'd worked with the college for many years beforehand, you know, I sought to make sure that we had enhanced engagement practice across the college in terms of our student body and in terms of our union colleagues. And they were very much part, in a consultative and progressive way, about what it is that we sought to do as a college, particularly when it came to dealing with the pandemic. And we've kept that and managed that through the pandemic and beyond it. But I do recognise, actually, in speaking to colleagues across the sector, that we're not all in the same place. And some of the things that we've set in motion, you know, even though the legislation doesn't necessarily allow us to do it per se, we've had our union colleagues on the board represent, for the last couple of years now, and so they get to see from the top and through the organisation exactly what we're doing, what we're planning, and they have input into that. And of course, we always know that we will at times differ in opinion, but we at least created the kind of professional fora to allow us to have those conversations and hopefully get, as Hugh has indicated, get something that's fundamentally impactful for those people that we serve.
And Joanna as well?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just to echo what's been said already, I mean, at local level, my experience of working with my trade unions is very cordial. We work collegially around some of the issues that we need to address together. So through the course of dealing with the impact of COVID, the trade unions were able to offer advice, support. We worked with them very closely. In terms of what's happened in the last number of years with national bargaining, I think the funding that we received from the Funding Council as we went through that harmonisation process was very welcome. But equally, I guess you could argue that it raised expectations going forward and has provided significant financial challenges for us as a sector. However, if we look at multi-year funding deals, then that gives us more scope to be able to not have to spend... I'll rephrase that. It gives us scope to be able to work in a more longer-term planning perspective with our trade unions around pay deals, etc. So the single-year funding deals have exacerbated, challenges in being able to afford what we can. And rightly so, our staff deserve the pay rises basically we would like to be able to be in a position to give them, but there's an envelope that we need to work within as well equally.
Thanks very much. I've got one final brief question, if that's okay, Convener. Hugh, you mentioned that there have been a number of lessons learned reports. The latest lessons learned report is still due a response from the Scottish Government. Does anybody have any particular points that you want to see in the Scottish Government's response to that? Any proposals from them on reforms to the NJNC, wider change in this sector? Is there anything in particular that you're looking for?
Hugh.
I await the Scottish Government's response with interest.
That was a politician's answer.
This is a question, I suppose, for Neil, Joanna and Angela, I suppose, on this matter. So what are the key reflections and recommendations following the regional tertiary pathfinder pilots? Which one would like to go first? Joanna.
Thank you. We're still working through those projects. So we have a programme board that's been established in the south of Scotland. We have three projects. One deals with a pathway between Dumfries and Galloway College and the University of West of Scotland. One deals with a digital skills hub, which we've actually been running for the last couple of years. And then the other one focuses in around net zero. I'm less familiar with the net zero one because it's a project between SRUC and Borders College. So we're working on a very fast-moving timeframe. The deliverables are expected in March next year. We're making good progress with those. However, it's too early for me to indicate to you, other than, it's been a very positive experience so far, but it's too early to comment on what the outcome of those is at this stage.
From my perspective, the timescales are pretty well the same as Joanna's working to, but there are four key strands to the North East Scotland Pathfinder projects. That includes the continuation and development of the NESCL IGU Strategic Partnership, which will include joint planning and provision of programmes, the development of pathways and possible shared services. And when we say shared services, we're talking about more targeted services for engaging learners, particularly those that are more likely to become disengaged or be disadvantaged. The three main tertiary providers, the two universities and ourselves, will be involved in a health and care partnership, and that will involve the promotion of pathways and work opportunities in health and social care professions. And then we go into, again, a tripartite arrangement around energy transition, which is about skills provision for transition and emerging industries and our net zero ambitions for Scotland and for the North East. And the final one, is which the college is actually leading on, is the review of the senior phase in the North East and how the three tertiary providers can actually impact more positively in conjunction with our local authority partners and the partner schools to better effect and in terms of, ultimately in terms of progression and attainment. There's one little thing that's in there that's quite important. I think it harks back to the Comfort Little report, and it's been touched on slightly here. Within the RGU-UNESCO strategic partnership, there is an exploration of creating a one-stop shop for information around tertiary provision in the North East and what that might look like for learners, for employers, for parents and other influencers. And I think there's some really good work that's already gone on predating the Pathfinder that will hopefully come to fruition in due course. But in there, it's about how the articulation arrangements that RGU and UNESCO have worked so hard to establish over the years for degree programmes can actually work for the apprenticeship family. And also we're exploring how we can actually create homegrown qualifications that are fit for the employers within our region that will kind of allow us to fast track what the skills deficits or needs are in those regions for our employers. And that's alluded to in the Cumberfield Little report as well.
Thank you. And finally, can we ask over to Angela, please?
Yeah, so I'll not repeat what Joanna has already said, apart from the project with SRUC and Borders College. It's actually around land base and natural capital, so it has a sustainability strand, but it is around that land base provision in the south of Scotland, making sure that we have a single offer, and then moves to joint curriculum development and then joint working around innovation and research in that space. I'll not be involved in the Pathfinders moving forward, but what I would hope would come out of that is that the sector is able to showcase how we work together using different types of models. So there is no one set way of collaborating, and there's different ways that we can work together to benefit our regions and national priorities.
Thank you. And I believe Willie Rennie has a supplementary on this.
Yeah, I just actually, it was on the trade union relationships, just to finish off on that point. I understand the relationships locally are good, but is that not because you individually don't have the power to give the trade unions what they're wanting? If that's the case, why collectively you're not able to do what you're doing locally?
We do have the power to give the trade unions locally what they're looking for, because all sorts of terms and conditions and ways of working and so on, where we make decisions at a regional level that impact on the working conditions of their members. So from that point of view, it's an effective relationship. I mean, the last few weeks I've been talking about to trade unions, the EIS in particular, around timetabling and class sizes and digital learning and all manner of different things. And these are all decisions that will be taken at the regional level. And it works. It works. I think when you bring it up to the national level, one aspect of it is that the often the people around the table, and I've not been too closely involved in national bargaining, but the people around the table are not working as closely as you would work at a college level. You know, I see my union reps in the canteen and was walking along a corridor and I'll say hello, and you've got a relationship with them, you've got an understanding, the communications flow and everything else. And I don't know whether that's one aspect of the national bargaining machinery where it doesn't work so well, because you don't have that chemistry, you don't have that regular communication. So, thinking about how you can start to make that work. And I know people like Stuart Brown at EIS have got some ideas about how we can make those sorts of changes. And it's down to people at the end of the day. And I don't think we'll be dismantling national bargaining anytime soon. And there's a lot of benefits that's flowed from it. So it's about, just as I said earlier, can we just sit around the table and make it work?
And Neil, you want to respond to that finally? Thank you.
Back to, again, reiterating something that's been Hughes raising there. My understanding is certainly since Gavin Donoghue's come into College of Employers Scotland, he's attempting to kind of build that way of working, because I think it is about relationship building, and at whatever level, that's what's going to produce the better outcomes, I think, in the longer haul.
Thanks.
No, thank you very much. And I would like to thank everyone for their time today. It's been a very informative session. Thank you so much. That's the public part of today's meeting now at an end. For those that have just walked in, I'm sorry. We will now consider our final agenda item in private. Okay, thank you.